Now open the Revere License Commission meeting. The first item is St. Mary's of the Assumption Church. This is an application for a special one-day license for malt and wine, common victuals, and entertainment. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Stephen Fielding, representing St. Mary's Church and Holy Name Society, 670 Washington Avenue, Revere.
Great, thank you. Can you give us some background as to the event that you're planning to hold?
Yep, this is the annual St. Lucie's Feast, which is a dinner dance. We have approximately 125 people attending. We're looking for a one-day malt liquor license, and basically we have a segregated area for the liquor, which is actually beer and wine, and we have people who are going to be managing the bar. There are no children involved in this event. Everybody is over 21, most likely over 65 that are attending. And basically, it's a controlled environment, so it's a very positive event.
Great, thank you. Any questions from the commission?
I have no questions.
I have no questions. I assume it's the same as it's been every year for the last 15, 20 years.
Yes, it is. It is.
So I have no objections, and if there's no one, no other questions, I'll make a motion to approve.
Second. So, motion.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good luck. Thank you. Item number two is Thomas Burger LLC. This is an application for a common victuals license and entertainment license. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Hi, my name is Zaid, Thweib. The address 5708 Broadway, Revere.
Okay, and could you give us a little background on your experience and what you're planning to do at this establishment?
Okay, I'm opening this restaurant with, I have my partner, and we're gonna sell like burger, fries, ice cream, milkshake, so.
And what are your hours? What
10
hours
to 10.
Sorry?
10 to 10.
10 to 10?
Yes.
Okay, great. And how many people, how many seats do you plan on having?
We have 16.
16?
Four tables, four chairs. Yeah.
Okay, beautiful.
The application reads that you put down for 20 seats.
It was Subway before us. They have 20 seats, but I mean, we just put four table, like we just have 16.
So do you want to apply for 20 and?
Well,
Sure.
I'd like to see what the what it was approved for, what the occupancy was approved for. We do have an occupancy report. I don't see it, do you? What was approved?
It's not in my package.
No, it doesn't say. We have to check because that's how we have to.
Well, they had 20 before.
Yeah, I don't see it at all.
Hmm?
I know. Yeah. I don't know. It doesn't seem to have any numbers on the application, so I think at this point you did pass the occupancy, but for some reason, I don't have a number for them. So,
okay. The landlord, he told me Subway, they have like, they got approved for 20 seats. So he told me like, I can have 20 seats. That's what he said.
So my question to you is, do you want to apply for 16 or do you want to apply for 20?
20, please, 20. If I can get 20.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, we're going to have to
amend
our agenda then, because our agenda was advertised as 16 seats.
What's that?
It's 20, we
get 16. Yeah, six, so we're going up. I mean, we're going down.
Right. So we're going up.
No, we're going down.
He wants 20.
He wants 20.
You want 20, right?
Yes. Okay.
Okay. 20.
Right. So.
Oh, we're going up 4. Okay.
We're going up.
Okay.
It was 16. He's now asking for 20.
No, I said, okay. He told me I can have 20, but I only put 16. If
right.
I can get 20, I appreciate it.
Well, it's just that that's how we advertise it. So.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay, so if he wants to
bear with us, 1 second.
Can I have an old application?
No, hold on. I'm in the wrong application.
Yeah.
I'm in the wrong order.
Okay.
No.
My application says 20.
Yeah, yours does, and I have one that says 16.
It does?
And then one that says 20.
So the actually, the application reads 20.
Okay.
Did we advertise for 20? We did. Okay. So 20 is acceptable in terms of it's been advertised as 20. It states on the application 20. The floor plan shows 16. So you're applying for 20. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Any questions from the commission?
No.
No, I mean,
I have. Have you been opening yet?
No.
You haven't opened?
Not yet.
No. Okay. And all the inspections have been done?
Yes. Okay. I'm just waiting for the, for today. I was waiting for today, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're ready to open now?
Yes, but if you said yes, okay, I open Monday because I have to make the orders for the food for those.
Right.
Okay. I don't have any other questions.
I have no other questions.
Are there any proponents that want to speak on behalf of this establishment? Hearing and seeing none, I'll close that side of the floor. Is there any opponents?
In favor.
What?
In favor.
I already did proponents.
Okay.
Are there any opponents? Hearing and seeing none, are there any final questions from the commission?
No questions.
I'll make a motion to approve. Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second the motion.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Great. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
I'm sorry, what were you asking? Item number three is Aladdin Sane, LLC, doing business as Philly Pretzel Factory. This is an application for common victuals license. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Good afternoon. Robert Gesek, 5 John Ave, Revere. The
Great.
Business is at 4 Squire Road.
Great. And that's the building that's at the Rotary, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Could you give us a little background on what you're planning to do?
Philly Pretzel is a franchise out of Philadelphia. It's got about 160 stores right now. We're the first ones opening up in the Boston area. I spent 20 years in Philly, so I know the product very well.
Okay.
Making fresh pretzels, basically, it's all hot out of the oven, made fresh daily.
Great. And are you proposing any seating, or is this going to be
all takeout? Yeah.
Okay.
bottled sodas and takeout pretzels.
Great. Any questions from the commission?
Parking, is there parking?
Yeah, there's 7 parking spots.
7 spots.
Okay. I'm just curious, you say you have another business. I don't know how that works. People just call and you deliver pretzels, big pretzels, so
it's
just
combination
for information.
It's more takeout party platters, football games. You know, we sell a ton of.
Oh, okay. It's more of a catering. Catering, larger orders?
No. People come in and buy one pretzel. They do specials, 3 pretzels for $2, 10 pretzels for $5. You know, they run different specials every Tuesday. So it's a lot of takeout business, people grabbing it for lunch. And then the party platters and the catering is above that, but everything is, you know, served right there on the spot.
Oh, nice!
Great.
Sounds good.
Oh, they're unbelievable. I wouldn't be up here if I was.
You should have brought some samples.
It's a long drive to Philly,
the
but there'll be plenty of samples at the grand opening. They do a week of like free pretzels for everybody.
Look forward to it.
Great. Thank you. Any other questions from the commission?
I have no questions.
Are there any proponents that want to speak on behalf of this establishment? Hearing and seeing none. Are there any opponents? Hearing and seeing none, I'll close that side. Is there a motion on the table to approve?
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second the motion.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Great. Good luck.
Thank you very much, guys.
Yeah, actually, pretzels are good. Item number 4 is Salvi Donuts, LLC, doing business as Dunkin' Donuts, 5 Ward Street. application for transfer of common victuals license.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the board. Salvi Kudo, 169 Main Street, Stoneham, Mass. Here on behalf of 5 War Street.
All right, thank you. And this is a transfer of a license?
Correct.
Common victuals?
It's just a cafe that's inside within the BJ's.
What is the transfer? Is it going from you to someone else or?
From BJ's to Salvi's Donuts LLC.
Okay, great. Any questions from the commission on that?
No, everything's going to stay the same.
Yes.
It's that little Dunkin' Donuts right inside of
The way the cafe is now, yeah, a bit of transition into a Dunkin' Donuts where the cafe is now.
So is it a company location or is it a franchise?
Franchise, location? Independently owned and operated network.
Okay. Great.
Yeah, everything's going to stay the same. There's no changes in hours or anything.
Everything will stay the same. BJ's will stay the same hours, and we're going to be there with them while they're open.
Okay.
Great, thank you.
I have no question.
Are there any proponents that want to speak on behalf of this establishment? Hearing and seeing none. Are there any opponents? Hearing and seeing none. I'll make a motion to approve. Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second the motion.
All of them in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Great. Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good afternoon.
Item number 5, Mary Wasso, doing business as Revere Psychic Studio. This is an application for transfer of a fortune teller license and a change of location. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Mary Wasso, 506 Revere Street, Revere, Mass.
Great. And you're transferring this license?
Yes.
To? Okay. And is the person who you're transferring it to here as well?
No.
Just you?
Just me.
Okay. Any questions from the commission on this?
You live at 506 Revere Street?
Yeah, I live at 506 Revere Street.
And whereabouts on North Shore Road from that area, 506?
Do you know where the limousine place is?
Yes.
Okay. Right on top, where the tailor is. I'm on the second floor, like right next to the tailor. It's 1040 North Shore Road.
So that's commercial property there?
Yes.
It is, okay.
Mm-hmm.
I wish that the applicant was here to ask questions. Normally, the applicant should be here to answer any questions. I mean, what experience does she have? I mean, does she work with you?
Yes, but she's not here. She left. She's to her sister. Maggie knows. I'm the applicant.
She's the applicant.
Oh, yes.
She's the applicant. Oh, okay. But the one that's transferring. But did you two work together at
yes.
one time? Yes, you did.
Yes, for years.
Right.
She is.
Oh.
Yeah. Perfect.
Okay.
All right.
No, but they were the
Sorry.
Two of them, and they were running illegal at 506 Revere Street, if you remember.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's the same people.
I got it.
From Revere Street, they went to Squire Road, now
yes.
North Shore Road.
From
right.
American Legion Highway to Squire Road, now moving to North Shore Road.
Right.
Yes.
And you were both together?
Yes.
Yes.
So going forward, are you going to both be together, or is it just going to be you?
Just me.
Just you. Okay. Okay. Any questions?
No.
Same signage?
Excuse me?
The signage?
Yes, they're already in the windows.
Everything's
they're already inside windows.
Great.
Same signs you guys know for years. I'm just moving them to different windows.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Are there any proponents that want to speak on behalf of this establishment? Hearing and seeing none, are there any opponents? Hearing and seeing none, I will put it up to a motion.
I'm willing to listen to anyone else's motion.
I'll make a motion.
Excuse me, I think there's a council that wants to speak.
Okay.
I think we asked for opponents, didn't we, and proponents?
Yes. Excuse me.
Oh.
Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Councilor Powers, 46 Naponta Street, Revere. My only concern is, if they had any other problems in any of these other locations they've been at of any sort. And,
Well, I just think at Revere Street, maybe they weren't licensed. There was an apartment, I think, on Revere Street. So, yes, we did have a problem. That's why I'm asking those questions.
What was the nature of the problem?
There was a problem on Revere Street. Well, I don't think it was really a business location. They were also living there at this time.
Okay.
So that you can't run a business out of your home. So
and that's
then they
not going to happen
move.
At this new location?
No, there'll be no living there. This is commercial property. But then from there, after we straightened that out, I think that's when they went to American Legion Highway.
You have your signs up already? You must have read your fortune.
But that problem was taken.
As long as
there's
no problems. I'm
there hasn't been any problems since she went from Revere Street to American Legion Highway and into Squire Road.
Okay. And I'm not opposed to it as long as there are no problems. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I'll make a motion to approve the transfer of license.
Is there a second to that motion? I'll second that motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Reluctant, but I'm doing it.
I'm going to get more than that.
Let's be charitable. Item number six is Revere Restaurant Group, Inc., doing business as T.O. Juan's Margarita's Mexican Restaurant. This is an application for a change of manager. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Sure. Ryan O'Leary, 38 Pearson Drive, Byfield, Massachusetts.
Great. And your position at Margarita's?
Manager.
Manager. And you're the manager coming in?
I'm sorry?
You are the manager
Correct.
Coming in?
Correct.
Okay. And any experience? How long have you been with Margarita's?
4.5 years with Margarita's.
Years. At this location?
No. I've been in other locations in New Hampshire. And when the previous manager left, I came down to see the restaurant.
Great. Thank you. Any issues at any of those locations while you were manager?
No.
Perfect. Great. Any questions from the commission?
I have no questions.
Great. Are there any proponents that want to speak on behalf of this establishment? Hearing and seeing none, are there any proponents? I'm sorry, opponents. Hearing and seeing none, is there a motion on the table?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Is there a second to that?
I'll second the motion.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Great.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck. Thanks. Item number seven is the Mirage, doing business as the Mirage Restaurant. This is an application of transfer of an all-alcohol restaurant license. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Attorney Lawrence Simeone for the applicant, 300 Broadway, Revere, Massachusetts. This evening, this is a updated version of the last transfer that we provided you that you endorsed and approved to the ABCC and got entangled by tax. We couldn't get a certificate of good standing for the Lobster Cabin, which had been out of business for several years. We've since been able to get a certificate of good standing. You have that from us now. All the hours remain the same. The manager has been the manager for 26 years. I think at some point you'll see the Mirage owners purchase the property in the near future to become the owners of the real estate as well as the license.
Great, thank you. Any questions from the commission?
No, I think we've been over this the last couple of years as to what was transpiring there. But the transfer of the alcohol, the sale of the property is not up yet.
No, it is not
yet. To sell that property. When there is the sale of the property, will that be that whole lot?
It'll be the remainder of the, it will be the entire lot. Yeah, Route 1, it's called Route 1A LLC, owns the full, all the property. And it will be for the entire amount.
Okay, so it's going to be the whole block there then.
It'll be that entire building, what used to be Jacob's Ladder.
Right.
What's over there?
So at this time, they just control the restaurant component of
they
the
They do.
Property.
They're the tenants of the LLC and have been for 26 years.
When you say tenant of the LLC, is that specifically the restaurant or is that all of the other portions of the building that...
Just the restaurant is the LLC.
And so the plan is long-term to purchase the property?
It's not long-term, it's short-term. Expect by the end of the year, they'll bring this to a conclusion.
And do you anticipate that the makeup of the business will change in any way when that happens?
The current owners of the Mirage are going to be the owners of the property, so I do not.
Okay. Any other questions?
No, I have no other questions. I think he answered most of our questions at the last meeting. So, and this is just the transfer of the alcohol license at this
point. That is correct.
There's
that's
nothing
all that's
else.
Left.
And right. Everything is the same.
Right.
Nothing's going
to
change.
As you know, Commissioner, it used to be an innkeeper's license, and then we modified that because we got rid of the innkeeper's function. And it's since that time, it's been a restaurant.
Okay. License. I have no other questions.
No questions. Great. Great. Are there any proponents that want to speak on behalf of this establishment? Proponents. Hearing and seeing none, are there any opponents? Hearing and seeing none, I'll close both sides. I'll make a motion to approve that. Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second the motion.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Great, thank you. Item number 8 is Esquina del Sabor. This is an application for a common victuals license. This is a common victuals license to be exercised at One Unity Ave for eat-in, take-out, delivery, table service of a Colombian food. Requested seating is 17. Requested hours of operation are Sunday through Saturday, 6 a.m. to 10:30 p.m. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Mr. Chairman, members, James Cipolletta, 385 Broadway, Revere, on behalf of the applicant, and Diego is with me today.
Right. And, Counselor, can you give us a little background on your client's experience and also what you're planning to do there?
So, beginning with the most recent experience, these people have been operating the establishment since 2015.
Excuse me one second.
Okay.
Okay, I'm sorry, continue.
Okay. So these gentlemen and lady, who's in the back row, have been operating the restaurant since 2015. They applied for a common victualer's license where there had previously been one in the name of the predecessor, who was also running, not a Colombian restaurant, but a variety store / food service under... It is loud. There had been a common victualer's license there for a number of years, and during the course of the active license in 2014 and part of 2015, these gentlemen and lady took over the business and remodeled the establishment, signed a new lease with Mr. Previty, who owns the block. The 2015 license existed in the name of the previous owner. That, by its terms, expired, and from our knowledge and research, was not renewed for 2016.
Do you have a copy of that agreement?
The agreement? I do
yes,
not.
The lease no. agreement.
I'm sorry?
Do you have a copy of the lease agreement?
There should be one in the file.
Isn't it? Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Okay. So the lease is in effect. When 2016 rolled around, the previous common victualer's license, to our understanding, expired. These gentlemen applied for it in their own name with the new lease and the updates and upgrades in the facility and the change of menu. There's litigation pending. I'm not handling that. There's another corporation that's suing this corporation and the landlord. I'm sure you're going to hear about it if you don't already have it in the file. That has nothing to do with whether or not the lease that is in effect and the operation that's being carried out there is worthy of the issuance of a common victualer's license. In fact, to our knowledge, there is no license at the establishment. It's been operating. It's been inspected a number of times, most recently, I believe, last week. And so Diego and his family are attempting at this point to comply with the city ordinance and the state law and to operate with the common victualer's license in their name. Notwithstanding any litigation for breach of contract with the landlord and the prior owner and whatever business dispute there may be among or between those corporations, I think that it's incumbent upon Diego and his partners to make application to the city to have a license granted that will allow them to continue to serve food at the facility under the grant of a license. So that's why we're here.
So are you operating under the old license?
There is no license. So
who is operating at that establishment?
Diego is operating under Esquina.
Under the what?
Esquina is the name of the short name of the restaurant. So when they took over the business from the prior owner, their initial agreement was that they would operate under his license. He kept that license in his name. It was not renewed in 2016. Diego filed an application for renewal, for a new license for a new corporation in 2016 with the new lease. And that's been sort of ping-ponging around until now. So
currently you have a lease that will take you into the next year?
Oh, indeed, yes.
Okay.
I think it was terminated by the, and that may be one of the predicates for the lawsuit, by the owner of the building when he entered and then subsequently entered into the lease with Diego. But Diego's lease, I believe, has a 2015 date on it. So I do not have a copy of the prior lease.
So in 2015, your client operated the establishment under another license?
Yes. Essentially, that's what was happening until he applied for his new license.
So this isn't a transfer. This is an application for a new license.
It's a new license, yes.
Okay.
And our understanding is that there is no license at that location.
But then how would you be operating without a license?
Well, they shouldn't be. He made the application. They just haven't had a hearing on it until now.
But I think in the meantime, he's had several visits about not having a license.
Well, yeah. See, he's had...
Right. He was working without a license, regardless of what this board did. And a lot of it, you're right, is a lot of legal paperwork mm-hmm. because of, I understood that the lease was still in effect, and then the landlord signed another lease on top of that.
Yeah.
So it's a lot of legal paperwork there. That's a reason for not getting a common victual license.
Right.
But on the other hand, he has been operating with no license.
But if it was my understanding at that time that it was a request for a transfer of licenses, not a new application, is that correct?
I think initially back in 2015 they may have asked for a transfer, and when the license expired and they did their upgrades and renovations and signed their new lease, it's now a new license.
Right. Well, when they asked for the transfer, someone already had it and said no.
That's right. That's right. So that's
I think the point is that there is no license now to transfer, so by default he has to apply for a new license. That's my understanding.
Well, someone has to have a license
right.
to be opened.
That's what we're trying to do. But notwithstanding the fact that he's had at least three or four inspections from city departments, and he's been signed off on a number of times, so he's been operating with the knowledge of the city and with the tacit agreement that he's to make the application, make things right, and get a new common victualer's license, which he is endeavoring to do. And I don't see anything in the application on its face that would preclude him from being a person suitable to operate the business, and the business not being suitable to be located at Unit 1 Unity Avenue. So I just don't want to get whatever's going on in court to spill over to here, because then that makes it, you know, exponentially complicated.
Right. I don't want to get into that part of it, because that's a court case.
But I think we need to look at this as this is a new applicant coming before the commission. At the time when they were looking for a transfer, we declined to transfer the license based on the fact that there was this dispute.
Right.
So now we're looking at the application as a new applicant with a new lease, and he has all the city approvals at this point. He does. So, excuse me. Sorry, I can't hear you.
Which one hasn't been approved?
Outstanding taxes.
But that's on
the landlord.
But that's the landlord, right?
Yeah.
There's outstanding taxes on the building. So, and water and sewer.
I think this is one unit, and like maybe there may be three different stores, and or two or three stores in that,
right,
that block.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
so
in his lease, is he responsible for his own water and sewer bills?
Let me ask you a question. Who is responsible for the water and sewer bills?
The owner pays.
You want to pay for that?
You don't pay any water and sewer? Okay.
Taxes? Nothing like that? You pay state taxes, but there's no property taxes associated with them.
Okay, so this is the only one that, can you read that? So small. So what's it? Needs a food service permit from Tom. Okay. Maybe the council wants to see that. If we want to show, do you want him to see that? She's supposed to pay that.
Yes. Council, I want to take it.
Yeah, can you just step up here for a minute? Up and over.
Take a look at that paragraph.
So, where is
Unity
at?
Beach
Crossing,
Beach
Station, the old
Providence Mart.
I think that's payable to the landlord. I think that's payable to the landlord, and then he pays, because Diego does not get a bill from the city in his name.
I probably agree with that. That's a great point.
Okay.
The city's not going to bill him.
Well, some people do, yeah. Yeah. Even the new apartments.
Yeah, but you're the owner. Oh, really?
Oh. But anyways, I don't know that that's going to have a lot to do with the official. It's not alcohol, you know. So I don't think anybody's going to go after him on that. But I'd like to hear the other side, what their rebuttal is to what he said.
Okay.
To make sure we're okay.
Mr. Chair, I may need to clarify one thing. He does pay his gas and electric directly.
Yeah. Okay. That's fine. At this point, we have questions, but I'd like to hear from any opponents at this point in time.
Sure. Thank you.
So I'd like to hear from the opponents of
I thought we'd hear the other side.
You want to hear proponents first?
No, I thought the attorney on the other side to rebut anything that
Yes.
Says.
Sorry.
Thank you, Commissioners. My name is Corey Rhodes. I'm an attorney with D'Ambrosio Brown, LLP, 14 Proctor Avenue in Revere. I represent Mawad Abu Galawa, the owner of Mecca Market or Corner Taste, which is the business that is at this location, that has been at this location for about 15 years. He is the lawful tenant of One Unity Avenue. And as the counsel did say, we are in ongoing litigation with this applicant for what can only plainly be described as the applicant's attempt to steal my client's business. And I do have copies of the complaint that was filed in the Superior Court. This is civil action 1684CV00817. This is a business that my client has really put together over the last 15 years, something he's grown, something he's invested a heavy amount of time and money into. And the applicant actually was someone who was his, basically his employee for the last 2 years. Someone that he was working with to run his business under his license. From that though, the applicant went behind his back and formed an agreement with the landlord, though there has been no eviction of my client, and my client has not abandoned the property, which is witnessed by the fact that we are suing him in Superior Court, and there has been no eviction action in Chelsea District Court. And we're here basically to state that he has no ownership rights in this business. He has no lawful tenancy rights to make this application. My client's license is outstanding. He still has it. It has not been remitted to the commission. It has not been renewed simply for the fact that we're concerned of what may be happening at the property that we're not aware of. But specifically, as was addressed by this commission, the more concerning fact is, though, the applicant made an application in January, but has continued to operate this business without a license. This is something you just can't do under state law. We're talking about a process that starts inspections and reviews by the city to keep people safe and keep people accountable. And that's something that he has just directly flaunted. And to the extent that he has done things to my client to try to steal his business, he has continued to make actions with this license that are just showing a willful disregard for the state law and for the authority of this commission. And this is something, you know, we're dealing with an unlicensed business here, something that's potentially highly unsafe. You know, we could have another incidents like Chipotle or something like that where a bunch of people get sickened, and who's going to be held accountable? Well, there's no license on file. We don't know who the owners are. We can't track them down. We can't sue them. We, you know, people can't get any kind of recovery. Because of these reasons, I think this application should be denied. But even beyond that, I think we should be looking to reprimand this applicant, fine the applicant, and potentially just shut him down completely until this action gets sorted out. He doesn't have the rights to do this, and I think the commission can see that.
During the time of his operation with whatever license, you've lost business, is what you said? You said that?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear the question.
During the time he was operating without a license, has your client been impacted?
Completely. My client has, since at least over a year, my client's been forced out of his business. And this gentleman's been pursuing his own things and taking in all profits and all actions and completely frozen out my client. And that's what predicated this lawsuit.
So at what time did your client give up the operating?
The operation, I think, was in about 2014. He started to work with this gentleman to have him operate his business, which at the time had some food service and also had some grocery aspect to it. But coming into the end of 2015, there was some collusion between the landlord and this tenant. The landlord stopped accepting rental payments from my client. And basically, the applicant changed the locks on the door, put up a new sign, and started a new business. But
so when in 2015 did that happen?
I think that was in November of 2015.
Just tell me, I'm a little confused.
Sure.
On the lease. The lease now is in the party that's there at the present time?
They have entered into...
Is your client's lease also still in effect?
My client's lease is still in effect. It has not been terminated lawfully by the landlord, either through an eviction action or some sort of abandonment or other terms of lease. That has simply not happened.
So the landlord has two leases going
Correct.
At the same time?
And so we're also suing the landlord.
Do you have a copy of that lease?
It should be in the file when the common vic was actually initially filed, but I can get another copy for you.
So who was making payments to the landlord during that period between 2014, start of the 2014 lease, and November of 2015?
My client.
And at any time during that period, was there anything ever done that would breach that contract?
Not that it was ever made aware of us or given them any lawful rights as far as we're concerned.
And did you get anything from the landlord saying that that your client is no longer occupying you?
No, just refusal to accept rent payments. That was what basically tipped us off, and I think the applicants also, their actions.
Did you... Do you have any kind of written contract with the party that's there now that he would be working?
There is an operating agreement, yes. It was an agreement that he would operate it for 2 years.
Only 2 years in Toronto.
Does the commission have a copy of that?
I don't. One was filed previously. I'm not sure if one has, but we can't.
I don't believe there is.
We can get you one. I'm sorry about that.
It certainly sounds like this really belongs in court. I don't think this is the place to resolve the leases.
What I'd like to do is establish who had control and who doesn't have control.
Well,
what you have
for the common vicular license, we have to know.
I'm not taking one side or another in the matter. All I'm saying is that to me, it's you've got an applicant who's applying for a new license, and my feeling is if that old lease is still in effect and there wasn't any termination of it, and he's got an agreement that is in place of the transfer of the business, then you could either say okay, they're tied or they're not tied, and they can take the rest of it to court. I'm just trying to figure out if the applicant today has any merit being before the commission for an approval. That's all.
And it is something that I think we're talking about, what the statute tells the commission to look to the public good and the public welfare. And if you look to Leggett versus the Board of Commission of North Adams, they're saying that the commission has broad authority to really see if, in their sound judgment, there is any kind of public welfare, public good aspects here. And I would say someone who has kind of disrespected the commission and disrespected the law by not having a license for the last 9 months, 10 months, really would show some doubt as to the trust that you can put in them in the future.
We do understand that, and this is not just today. We've been watching this for a few months, as you know.
Yeah.
But I would just like to hear from, if he's done, let's hear from our proponents and see okay. if they can add anything that can help the situation.
Yep. So at this moment, I want to hear from proponents of the applicant. Proponents. Of the applicant.
Proponents.
So that would be proponents of La Escuela del Sabor. Hearing and seeing none, are there any opponents? Please state your name and address for the record.
Yes, Judge Rotundo, 1123 Revere Beach Parkway. My greatest concern is, simply put, the proponent for the license states that he doesn't have a license and that he had several inspections done by the city. My concern is, how is the city and why is the city inspecting a property that doesn't have a license, number one? That jeopardizes the entire city, it jeopardizes the various departments that go down there and inspect.
Counsel, can I just interrupt you for 1 minute, just so that, just to clarify something? Before we give out a license, they do that first. We have to get sign-offs from everyone first.
So my question is it, did they sign off on this gentleman's license, which is what it sounds like, because the other person didn't have a license? So everything that was stated by Counsel Cipolletta, in my impression, is that what was signed off by the various departments was signed off underneath the vehicular license of Sabir. So then I would like that you would take that into account. More importantly, to me from the outset, the other question that comes to mind is, are they following E-Verify? Are they ensuring that the people that are working there are able to work there underneath federal law, regardless of state law? And that's also a concern. But more importantly, if we allow a license to get transferred based upon this current performance, including the issues that are before the court, it's a terrible precedent to set. And I would hope that you would deny the license, because this type of behavior is untoward and, as far as I'm concerned, unnecessary. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other opponents?
Thank you. Patrick Keefe, 44 Kilburn Street, Revere. I know that there's some legal formality happening here, so I don't want to get too much involved in that. But I think I overheard the Honorable Counsel talking about taxes due and water bills due that are passed due from the owner of the property. I think we would take away our only leverage point by granting a license to a business at the property from the current owner of the property if we were to grant that license. So I think that's a huge leverage point to cease and desist any business operations until the city receives the dues that are owed. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Any other opponents?
Stephen Fielding, 153 Gore Road, Revere. As a municipal employee, I have to say that I can't speak to the legal aspects or what is happening in regard to your decision-making process here, but I can speak to the character of Sabir. I know that he is a very generous individual who works thoroughly hard. I know that he has contributed to the senior population in great detail over the last 3 years, and I can speak to the fact that I don't believe he is the type of person who would come up here and misstate anything that is going on, and I would hope that that would be taken into your consideration as well.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Others, other opponents?
Joanne McKenna, Ward 1 Councilor, 830 Winthrop Avenue. I'm here to speak on Sabah's character. He is a wonderful neighbor. I've known him for 15 years. He's run a great establishment down in Donnelly Square. He's a very giving man. He's given 100 turkeys. Actually, the city council just gave him an award for giving 100 turkeys that he cooked himself to local churches so he could so they could feed the homeless and the needy. So that's why I'm here, just to for his character. Thank you.
Thank you. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Bill Jackson, 95
Stanton Avenue, Revere. I'm sorry. Say it again.
Yeah, my name is Bill Jackson, 95 Stanton Avenue, Revere. Frankly, I am incredulous, if not embarrassed, to have to speak before this commission on behalf of my longtime friend, Sabir Abu Alala. Incredulous, because I find it hard to believe that this hearing is even necessary. Embarrassed that this man must be put through this ordeal. And by the way, it is an ordeal, because when he called me, he said he thought he was going to have a heart attack. But I am unconcerned about what the outcome of this hearing will be. Although I know some of the details of this hearing are, I am not here to speak about them. Ultimately, this case will be decided in a court of law. Rather, I am here to speak about my friend Sabor, and he's been my friend for many, many years. 16 years ago, Sabor came to America from Egypt, to this great land of opportunity. And that is what he was looking for, an opportunity to do his best for his family. He did not come with his hand out. He came to work as hard as he could in order to succeed. And succeed he did. He just opened his third business across the street, the Broadway House of Pizza, which is already a huge success. Why? Try the pizza, as I have, and you will get the answer. He owns the Good Diner, which I suggest be renamed the Great Diner. That's how good it is. Then there is his third business in Beachmont, which is the subject of this hearing. These businesses employ our residents, and we all know that employment in this country is not so good. These businesses generate taxes for our city, and they provide good food at reasonable prices for our citizens. Beyond all of this, his generosity to causes in Revere are numerous. Providing food to events within his faith. Providing turkeys at Thanksgiving to churches and to our senior center. And other acts of charity too numerous to mention here today. I consider it to be a privilege to know Sabor, and I thank him for all he has done for the people of Revere. Thank you.
Thank you. Any others? Please. Please state your name and address for the record.
Yeah, I'm the associate pastor of the First Congregational Church of Revere. I'm also live in Revere, 40 Winthrop Ave. I'm here on behalf of being a character witness for Sabor. As was mentioned, he is a wonderfully generous man. Every year we have a Thanksgiving dinner at our church. We offer Thanksgiving for the homeless and anyone in need for Thanksgiving on that day. And he comes and offers turkey, mashed potatoes, green beans, goes above and beyond in generosity, covers the cost himself. Humble man, doesn't want attention, doesn't seek attention. Someone who loves his establishment. I'm a neighbor of the Good Diner. And as someone who lives nearby, I just love how he respects, keeps a clean property, great food, great place to visit. My kids love going there. So someone who just really cares about Revere and is involved in Revere, loves this city and cares about it. So as a pastor, someone who lives in Revere, I want to speak to his character, his humility, his generosity, his love for this city, his care for what's going on here, and saying that that is something we want to support and see more of in this city. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other opponents? Please. Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Morris Morris, 19 Standish Road, Revere, Mass. I'm a World War II veteran and president of the Revere Allied Veterans Council. I met Mr. Sabor a few years ago. He came to me to be on the show, but what he did on the show is unbelievable. He came in with 5 gift certificates to be given out to veterans who have served in Afghanistan and Iraq for each one that came on there. Then I introduced him to the senior center, to Mr. Steve Fielding. Mr. Fielding will tell you the excellent job that he did there. He's done the things for the Congressional Church with the pastor, show you, for the Beachmont VFW. I wish the city of Revere had 100 more like him. We'd be the number one city in the country. So I want to thank you, Sabor, for everything you do for the veterans and for the community. And I want to thank you all for giving me this honor to speak for him. Thank you.
Any other opponents? Hearing and seeing none, I'll close that. Do you have counsel? Can you address?
It's indeed heartwarming to know that the gentleman has so many friends and that he's involved in so many community activities, and that's great. We need more people like him, and the city would be well on a better trajectory if we did, but that's not the issue. And maybe the people and the politicians who come and stand before the commission and tell you how wonderful Samir is, and I'm sure it's all true, can go to Suffolk Superior Court and tell that to the judge. But that's not going to have any sway when the judge determines whether or not the legal papers that he or she has before him or her are to be decided in favor of the current lessee or the prior lessee. And this is not a personality contest, and I'm sure that both of these gentlemen are a benefit to the city and have, I don't think that you've had any complaints but from any of Samir's businesses or Diego's businesses. So, you know, that's an aspect of this controversy that's not before the commission. What is before the commission is that there was a license application that was made that should have been heard in January, and it wasn't. And we're here now in September, and we're having a hearing on it. And whatever the reason is, that's fine. But those are the issues, and the issues are very narrow that are to be determined and adjudicated by this commission. Yes, there may be an issue over tenancy, whether or not the landlord properly revoked the license. The lease of the prior owner. That's to be determined by a court of law. And if there are money damages to be paid, then the landlord's going to pay them. If the judge determines that there was a dispute between the landlord and the tenant, and that the landlord is right, the judge will grant judgment on behalf of the landlord. That's not before the commission. If there was a breach of any duties on behalf of the previous tenant to the landlord, or the landlord to the previous tenant, again, that's a superior court judgment to be made. There is, right now, the landlord is acting as if the prior owner has no lease. Regardless of what there may or may not say be written on the lease that is in the file of the commission, the landlord may have revoked it. We don't know what happened. We don't know the facts. And as I said at the outset, I don't represent Diego in the civil suit in Superior Court. He has other counsel to handle that. He did not attempt to renew his lease for 2016. These are things that the judge is going to take into account when he or she determines whether or not the lawsuit brought by the previous owner has merit or doesn't have merit, and will be applied accordingly. There's no lease, there's no eviction. Nobody has moved to evict Diego from the premises. He has a lease, you have the lease in front of you, and it is of current date.
Counsel, but nobody made any attempt to evict the former owner either.
I'm not sure that he did. I think that's why they're before the Superior Court. I think that the landlord evicted, either constructively or otherwise, and that's why there's a controversy. And I assume, and I think it just makes sense to conclude that the controversy before the Superior Court is whether or not the termination of that lease was lawful. It may have been. That's why it's submitted to the court. There's no injunction against the city from issuing another license. There is no license. There's not an application for a renewal of the license by the prior owner. This is simply, and I don't think that the court has jurisdiction, nor is it being asked to determine the rights of Diego in a license. This is a landlord-tenant and a issue. In the first instance, and in the second instance, it's a contract issue between those two businessmen. But I don't think, and I haven't seen the complaint that you were just handed, but I would be surprised to see whether to learn that the prior owner is asking the judge to issue a license, because I don't think the judge can. I think only this commission can issue the license. And there's only one application before the commission, and that's the one that's being made by Esquina.
I'll be honest, you know, from my standpoint, you know, although your client could run a well-established business and can demonstrate that, you know, when we're taking into consideration all of the different aspects of an application, I mean, one of the things that you want to make sure is that you've got somebody in there who is going to do right by the public. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that he can't. He's obviously demonstrated that he's been operating in business. However, based on the facts here, I just can't see myself approving this license based off the fact that there's been this dispute. It's been ongoing, and at this point, I'd like to see how it's resolved before I approve a license going forward.
I understand that, but that would then be concluding that the prior owner that his case is more meritorious than Diego's case, and the commission doesn't have those facts. You don't have the discovery. You don't have. And I understand why you're trying not to take a side one way or the other. If there's, and I don't know what the scheduling order is in Superior Court, and because it has a 16 designation, I think the case number begins with 16. It was filed in 2016, not in 14, not in 15, that it's probably in the early stages of the proceedings. My role in this and getting involved with Diego a few weeks ago was to make sure he got up on the radar here at the commission, and that when the people come to inspect and his customers come in, and they, and anybody who has the right to wonder whether or not he's licensed, at least is able to be given the explanation, we have a license pending. We've let the city know that we're here. They know we're here, and they know what we're doing. We've been doing it for a year and a half. If the commission is, in an abundance of caution, inclined to not, at this point, approve the license, then if you would want to hold the decision in abeyance, would waive the amount of time and exclude those days from the time of this hearing until the time of the decision, if you want to wait to see what happens in the court. But I think if you deny the license, then what you're doing is you're deciding the case that the judge should be deciding. And again,
I don't think that's the case at all. I think the case is that we've got an applicant before the commission who's applying for a business. Background obviously comes into play anytime you're dealing with that. I mean, that's the whole purpose of the application mm-hmm. process. And based off the facts right now, I find it difficult to be able to make that decision.
Okay.
To approve.
Can I just say something? I don't know the legality of what I'm going to say to both councils. I could be way off track here. If we deny the license, obviously he has got to be shut down. He can't operate without a license. We also have something here from the Board of Health that he still needs another permit. So today, I would think how we vote could close this establishment, which I would want it closed down. They can't operate without a license. Mm-hmm. And here's where I could be way off. Is there such a thing where the court has got to decide the legal aspect of this with the lease on the property? In any way, could this somehow put the common vic's license in both of these applicants' names, as you were working before? I believe the two of you were, I guess you had the license, but he was working under the license. Then if we did that, the attorneys were in favor that if we did do that, the business could stay open, and then we would have to wait for a ruling from the courts as to who actually leased the property and can legally stay there.
I'd like to hear from the other side in terms of if that would be something that would be acceptable to.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I'm just putting it out there. I don't know if it's acceptable. I don't know if it's legal or if they even want to do it. I'm just looking for a way, because I think it's a very hard decision here today. And I see both sides. And today, I don't know. I don't see a winner here. I don't know how it could be worked out. But where they did work together, you have a court case going. If we could see what happens in the court. In the meantime, they both own the common vic license, and then it would have to come back to the board. I'm willing to listen.
I mean, let me make one point here. In terms of do I think the applicant has merit in coming before the commission for approval? I guess my question is did the former owner make any attempt to renew the license when it came up for renewal? Because at that point in time, they had the ability to do something about it, right? Either they non-renew it.
Well, he did try several times, and we did not put money into it.
The former.
The former, yes, he did.
He did, okay. So yes. He did. So so my feeling on that is that I mean, I think that clouds the issue, but in my mind, to me, that's actually a key component, is that he made the attempt to come back here to renew the license. The commission knew you were involved in a lawsuit and didn't take action at that point. I think that I think I'm going to change my position and say that I don't think you could the fact that we didn't make a decision on the renewal of the license, I think would prohibit us from approving a new license, new applicant on that particular business.
Just to address the 2 points, kind of dual ownership of the license, I think there could be some odd kind of rights involved there, and liability would be a big concern if something were to happen at the property, especially where my client doesn't have any actual day-to-day control and is actively in litigation with the applicant. We would have some concerns there. And to address what you raised as well, Commissioner, this matter is perfectly within this commission's jurisdiction and their purview. Substantial questions have been raised about the validity of the business that's there and the character of the applicant. And just given those two facts that, you know, these are things that point directly to kind of the public good for approving this license. And that even a case that involved this commission, Mello v. License Commissioner of Revere, the court stated that it provides further that the statute shall not require license commissioners to grant a common victualler's license if, in their opinion, the public good does not require it. And I think that gets to someone to the point that there's character issues, there's validity issues. It's not necessarily something that this commission should be approving.
Thank you.
So I'd like to hear what they're thinking, what the attorneys are thinking.
So, Mr. Chairman, I think just one procedural point and one factual point. So I understood that the prior owner did not renew for 2016, as was stated during his presentation, because they weren't sure what was going to happen at the court, and they didn't want to put themselves in the position of liability. So I'm not really sure that that renewal ever came before the board, but I think a more important point that I need to make, and I need to make on behalf of Diego, is anytime you make a comment about character, that's very dangerous ground, and I don't think we have any evidence of bad character on behalf of that.
I don't think anybody's suggesting that, Counsel.
Well, I mean, I think the argument's been made that when you consider whether or not to give a license, you need to take into account the character. Where you have two people who are involved in what seems to be a very contentious court battle, each one is going to say the other guy's a bad guy. So I hope that you're not taking that.
Counsel, I'm not taking that into consideration at all, honestly.
I don't think anybody is here.
I just need to put that on the record for Diego's benefit. And also, I don't see any, and I've heard one of the possible solutions floated that, well, we're just going to close them down. And I want to know how that's going to do anybody any good if you did that.
Well, he can't stay open without a license. You can't operate.
And Previty's not going to rent to the other guy. So what you're going to have is an empty store. And when people stood up here and told you how opening small business people opening businesses is good for the economy and good for jobs, I don't see how that end is met. I would propose I would go out on a limb and speak for Diego to say this. If you want to issue the license as a temporary license pending the outcome of the court case, at least that gives some legitimacy to whatever is operating down there and does not shut down a small business that's been operating for a year and a half. And if the court says, well, Mr. Samir has the rights to the lease, then so be it. Then the license goes away. But I don't think it does anybody any good to close down a business and leave another vacant storefront to beach
work. That's exactly what I'm getting to, Council. I don't want to see it shut down, but if there's not a decision made today and it doesn't go in favor of your client, he's going to have to be shut down.
Well,
I think if we could work together and you could understand, if you have no problem letting us renew it to the previous owner, as you said, when he goes to court, I mean, he'd have to work under his license. They would have to work together. If we renew that, when you go to court, if Previty says he does not have a lease, then he can't have a common victual license there. So we would have to take that license. Then your applicant could get the common vic license.
I'm just not sure how that would work.
Go ahead. Please.
Well, it stops any closing of any business.
No, I understand.
Please state your name again for the record, please. Sorry.
I just want to make sure I'm understanding this. Are you suggesting to issue the license jointly so that my client would be able to work there and would not be subject to supervision or management by the prior owner?
I'm not suggesting.
I heard it two different ways. I just wanted to
make sure. I'm just trying to find a way that I can put a common victual license there.
Right.
Without having to close your client down.
Well, how about giving it to the landlord? Put it in the landlord's name.
Well, I can't because there's a dispute here. I don't know what's going to happen. What if the court turns around? You know, now the landlord has a license. We can't
What I'm trying to avoid, and, you know, the concept of a joint license isn't all that repulsive. That's fine.
Well, maybe we won't do joint. Don't we just give it back to the original?
Then that would be a denial, and you're just going to end up in court again tomorrow. That doesn't make any sense either.
No, but you win in court with the lease.
No, I don't have that. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the license.
If your client wins,
right,
then he has no right to that property.
But if you give it to the prior owner, then what you're doing is you're foreclosing the guy who's in there operating the business under an existing lease.
Oh, he would have to agree to let him run it, and however they were doing it beforehand.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's going to work. I mean,
I'm trying to find out.
I am, too.
If that doesn't work, then...
I'm trying to find a common ground where...
Right.
A solution as well where an operating business is not closed down, you don't have an empty storefront. And at the gateway to Beachmont. Just doesn't make any sense. I mean, he's there operating. He's been operating since 2014. There haven't been any complaints. If you give him the license and the court says your lease is no good, then you revoke the license. I mean, it's simple as that. Let the court take the heat on this one. But right now, all you have is the guy who, you have no license there. You have a gentleman who's running a business, has for a year and a half. He's proven that he can run the business, and it's operating. Why not give him the license? Is there a reason not to give him the
because
license?
Because we denied a hearing to the original license holder. We denied him a hearing because of this litigation in court. So now we said, we're not going to hear it. We want to find out what's going on in court. Now someone comes in and applies for him. We say, okay, we're giving it.
Well, they applied in 2015 for a 2016
license. So didn't the previous owner. We didn't hear it.
I mean, I think what to me, it's almost like there wasn't going to be an agreement on the transfer, so now we'll come before the commission on a new application. That's how I'm viewing that, based off of what I'm hearing. And that's what it looks like to me.
Well, there
I mean, you've got the same establishment he was operating prior to, you know, the disagreement, right? And at the same location. And then on top of it, you know, he, on a number of occasions, he was warned by the health department and by the police department that he needed to come in and resolve his license. And
continued to operate.
Continued to operate and never submit any paperwork.
I mean, he's had that license application sitting there for 9 months.
No, he didn't fill them out until June. We started in January. He did not bring them back till June, and every month he was asked to fill out the papers. First time we got them was June.
It doesn't give me any pleasure to sit here and tell you that you know we want to shut somebody down. I mean, that doesn't give me any pleasure in doing that. I mean, we're talking about people's livelihoods here. However, based off the facts that there was the dispute in the transfer, and now you've also got a landlord who's willing to give somebody a new lease at the same location, just complicates the matter. I just, in good conscience, based off those facts, forget about the character of any of the people involved, you know, on either side and the landlord. I'm not making any judgment on anyone there. I'm just saying that based off all of the things that are taking place in this, I can't approve this license.
So, are you denying the license?
I haven't made a motion yet. I just want to get all the information. Please, state your name again for the record.
Bill Jackson, 95 Stanton. Councilor Cipollotta, a moment ago in this presentation that you just made, Cipollotta, a moment ago in his presentation, mentioned the word character. I spoke about character, okay? I have a question. The question is, where are the character proponents for this man that wants to have this license? There's nobody. What about the customers? What about the people next door?
Sir, all I really want to get to right now is the facts.
We've already closed the hearing on proponents.
Bear with
This is going to be the last statement I'm going to make. The only thing I can do, I don't really want to see anybody get hurt here, but it looks like it could happen and we're going to have to shut down, is that I would be willing today to vote to give the common vitual license back to the original with saying, this is if you two attorneys agree, saying that he can still run the business there, while, although you're saying there's an insurance, a liability there.
There would be a number of points that I think that would have to be worked out, like liability. That would be the biggest one that comes to mind.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's very hard. I mean, there are a lot of legal issues there. But I hate to see either party go out of business over this, but it looks like we have no...
Can I make a suggestion? If we are willing to continue...
Please speak up into the mic, please.
Sorry. We're willing to continue this on to the next hearing and continue the hearing on that narrow subject alone. I have not, because again, for the third time, I don't represent these people, anybody in this controversy in Superior Court. They have corporate counsel. But now that there's been a suggestion made with regard to legal issues surrounding the license, it may be worth having licensing counsel speak with counsel and have a amount of time to try to work it out along the lines of the commissioner suggested. If we're looking to get some common ground, that may be worth a shot. I don't know. But
I mean, we've got a dispute over the same property, and that to me is the bigger problem. That's part of the reason why we tabled it at the beginning, because we wanted them to resolve the dispute between the two parties. That hasn't happened.
Right.
And I think enough time has gone by to do that. And hear me out. And I think that based off that fact, I'm not in a position to approve this license. I would rather table it for a week or two. In that period, your client would not be able to operate. And that I would like to get a copy of the agreements between the parties. I'd like to see them all, and then I'd like an opportunity for us to be able to look at it, review it, talk to the city solicitor about it, and then come back with a decision. Otherwise, if you press me to make a decision today, my position would be I turn the application down.
Would it make a difference if we you people went into recess and we heard you after the next hearing, and if you can work something out?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so.
You're not the parties anyway.
But here's what you may be overlooking is Diego has a lease. He is operating, and he's been there for a year.
But that's my point, counselor.
I understand.
We don't
just
have,
because the other
second,
side
counselor.
Is saying that his lease is not valid. But he's operating under the lease, and they need to turn that lease over, which they haven't done. They may do it, but that's up to another forum to decide that and argue it. That's the Superior Court.
Why is that up to another forum? Why can't that?
Because they've filed
we're talking about the same location, counsel.
If you're talking about the same location, then there's only one lessee, and it's Diego, because he's in there, and he has a lease, and you have it in front of you.
This is a new lease. Is that correct?
It's a 2016-2015 lease. It's not the it's not the lease that the prior owner had. I mean, I think you have to, as a adjudicatory body, you have to take what you get, and you have it on face value. That lease is valid.
I understand that, but I also want to see the agreement between the parties and how they transferred the business. I'd like to see his lease agreement and your lease agreement.
But you have our lease agreement.
I understand that. I understand.
You want the whole package.
That's what I want.
But I don't see a reason to close him because you need more info.
Well, right now he's operating without a license.
If you want to deny him, we'll be in Superior Court tomorrow. That's probably where it's going to end up.
That's right.
There's no reason to deny the license just because another jurisdiction or another level of adjudicatory body has this matter under advisement, and that's the Superior Court.
Well, I think
you can't say that lease is not valid.
No, the reason that
I'm not
saying
it's not valid,
we would not give the previous owner a hearing because of this. So telling him you can't have a hearing because it's in litigation and you're the lease, now to go with a new applicant and say, okay, we'll hear his, like, that's what I'm going on. I personally feel bad that you two couldn't come to an agreement so this doesn't have to happen. But it looks like we're going to have to continue it if you want. I would be willing to have a special hearing in a couple of weeks if they, you know, see if you can work something out. But in the meantime, counsel, he can't stay open. I mean, you just can't do that.
I think what you need to do is you need to give us the right to go to Superior Court. Deny the license if that's what you're going to do. Because if you're going to tell him that he's going to close for 2 or 3 weeks until we come back here and rely on somebody else to give you information and he's out of business, we may as well just construe that as a denial. And you don't have a basis to deny it.
Based off of what, why are you making that?
Of course he's going to object to it.
Oh, no, I'm not talking
about
counsel, you always have the right to appeal. You can appeal.
I know, but we need something to appeal. If you're going to, I would say that that makes an abundant amount of sense if you're going to let them continue to operate while somebody else is giving you information. But to close him while you're waiting for information makes no sense.
But he doesn't even have the proper licenses.
Counsel, we have something from the Board of Health that has not
asking for the license.
He does not have a Board of Health. I'm sorry?
The inspections.
Yes.
And if something happens, shame on this board that we didn't have all the inspectional services there.
Agreed.
Thank you.
It would come back to us, counsel.
So what's lacking from the City of Revere that they haven't given you?
What was it?
I'd like to see the agreement between the parties.
Yeah, but that's not a city. What has the City of Revere not done, not given you? I mean, the Board of Health.
I'm sorry. Where was it? Yeah, it was the... It was from the Board of Health.
Yeah, it was from the Board of Health.
Food permits.
He has no food permits.
So do we get him here? It's a $175 application fee. Is that what it is?
Are you going to Board of Health?
He's also serving food without a food permit.
Right. And he is serving food. So the more we talk about this, the more violations are coming up on this property. So I think we really should just make a decision here. Counsel, if you are, you know... You think that it's better for a denial and just go for an appeal?
Well, I mean, you're going to close them anyway. You may as well give them the right to appeal what you did.
But we're given an opportunity for us to take the information and review it versus just shutting them down.
Right.
But if you're telling us to shut them down.
No, I'm saying that if you're going to shut them down anyway.
But don't you think there's a difference in how we're
no.
You don't?
No,
fine.
I don't.
Okay, fine. Is that it? Are there any other opponents? Hearing and seeing that, I'll close that. I'll make a motion to deny the license. Is there a second to that motion? Okay.
That's what he wants. I'll make a second. I'll second the motion.
No, it's not what he wants. It's what you were going to do. You were going to close him.
I think I gave you several options.
I mean, I gave you more than...
You gave us no viable options. What you did is you took something that's in front of you, that's a valid lease.
So what you're telling me is giving us the ability to review and set up a special meeting in a short period of time...
But you're asking him to close.
...is not as good as just closing him down, period? Is that what you're telling me?
I think you're any closure notice... And if you want to give me 10 seconds, I'll ask him if he's willing to close or he wants to go to court.
He doesn't even have the proper permits.
I understand, but he's here asking for the proper permits.
Go ahead, ask him.
I think we're going to stay on this another 10 minutes. We have one more hearing. Actually, we have two more hearings here. It's now almost 5 o'clock. City Hall will be closing.
No, I don't really want to do that.
They did not. They did their full minute for a moment. She seconded the motion, then they have to vote. There was another fact to throw into this. My client said the hours have been extended beyond what he had ever had under his license, and there are tables, so for whatever it's worth.
And 6 a.m., we don't give 6 a.m.
Thank you.
What date did the commission have in mind for the next?
Well, Are you going to appeal our decision, or you want it?
Well, if you're not making a decision, I can't appeal it. But if you're going to set a meeting in a short order,
a week, Linda, 1 week.
I'll go with a week if he wants to come back in a week. What? Going away?
I mean, I think that gives us an opportunity to look at this thing and look at all of the documentation.
All right. I think that
would be fair for all parties involved.
Excuse me. She'll be gone the 29th or the 12th. To the 11th.
Next Thursday.
Next Thursday?
Yeah. Yeah. Till the 12th.
Okay. Just letting you know.
What's the date?
We're trying to decide. Secretary's going on vacation.
Your calendar look like?
I get a couple things.
I do too.
Yeah. It's only right here on Wednesday.
That's fine.
Would an hour earlier potentially work? I do have a zoning hearing in this room on a big project at 4:00. So could we potentially do 2? Okay.
2:00.
Thank you. That's better than a few weeks.
Well, I don't think I said a few weeks. Did I? My apologies. All right. So a week from today, 2:00.
And just so we'll know,
I want the agreement between the parties on the lease. I want the lease agreement, your lease agreement, Councilor, your lease agreement, and then Councilor Cipolletta, I have yours.
That'd be fine.
Okay, that gives us an opportunity.
I'll try to get whatever from the landlord and the landlord's attorney as well. We'll try to have a landlord fine here.
And also, you're going to be closed. They'll be closed down. I'm sorry. I was just questioning the hours.
So we're going to put that in the form of a motion. Okay. So we're tabling this matter for 1 week to what's the date, Maggie?
28th.
July 28th, 2 p.m. The establishment will be closed in that period of time. And then, Council, you'll provide us with an agreement between the parties in your lease agreement. Okay? And we have yours.
If we could get copies of that as well. I don't have copies of any of that.
That is in the form of a motion. Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second the motion.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, just so for public record, there'll be a special hearing on this matter next Wednesday, July 28th at 2 p.m. in this September. Sorry, why keeps September 28th at 2 p.m. I'm still on vacation mode. I'm sorry. All right. Where were we? Nine. Okay, we got an application for common victualler's license. This is an application to amend an.
Excuse me, sir. Counselor. We're going on the application to amend the application. I think we should do a hearing on the violations.
Okay. Great. Okay. Perfect. So we're going to go out of order. We're going to take hearings next. Item number 10 is Four Partners, Inc., doing business as Antonia's at the beach. And then we'll take on the application to amend for an entertainment license. Please state your name and address for the record, please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the commission. Attorney Joseph P. Francisi for the Antonia's on the beach.
Great, thank you.
Good afternoon, Alice Herrera, 188 Chelsea Street, owner of Antonia's.
Great, thank you. And so this is a hearing concerning possible violations of entertainment licensing laws and state regulations and noise complaints. This is continued from August, the August meeting. Commissioner? Do you want to address that, or?
No, I would like to hear from them why all these complaints at one time. Your doors have been open, your windows were open. Police have gone down there on several occasions. You had live dancing going on. You had bands going on. People out there late at night, and I think Lieutenant Randall did go down there on a few occasions. And I'm a little perplexed when we send someone down there and you go down the next night and lo and behold, there's still dancing in there and doors wide open. You're very close to a condo there, and we get calls all hours about the noise coming out of there, and yet you continue. I'm just a little taken back by that. Can you tell me
Madam Commissioner, let me explain to you, since my involvement in this matter, I believe the commission issued a formal letter of complaint July 13th. Mr. Herrera immediately called me within a week. I responded. I sent down a letter of representation. I went down to the establishment. I spoke with him, the members of the staff that worked there, his entertainment director. I explained to them that the city has very strict noise ordinances regarding 70 decibels. That everything has to be down below 70 decibels.
Right.
I've been in the place, I grew up in Winthrop, I've known Revere, and I've been in that establishment numerous times. I made a walkthrough, and I explained to him how the noise may project out of the door. My client explained to me that at one time the handicap access door was left open, which allowed the music and the noise and entertainment to go out and adversely impact the residents in that condominium next to him. North of the Revere Beach.
That was the only door open because we always keep windows and the main entrance closed. So the reason was that a couple times or three times, the handicap that we use for handicap access, someone get through the handicap door and the door was left open, and we noticed later when someone complained about the noise.
I'm very familiar with the building, but I know and I appreciate it. When you came on, things did change.
Thank you.
And I did get the letter from you stating that they would abide by the laws. But I'm speaking about before he hired you.
Yeah.
Absolutely no regards to any police that went down there or any commissioner that went in there and checked. And it continued. And it was very upsetting to me. And then we went on your website after they were told no dancing. And here we see live dancing Friday night, karaoke, and this was after he was warned. So I was just confused as to now you want dancing and you want...
No, we understand. That was a mistake that we did. And after the police went in there, we took all the everything out of the website. You might saw that before the police went in there. But one of the reasons that is really hard for us too is when people sit down and have dinner and they get up and just move around the chair, we usually go approach them and let them know that we know we don't have license or we don't have the permission to dance. But sometimes it's really hard for people to understand that, you know. And at the same time, it's mean when you go there, you cannot get up in the table and move, you know. And it's older people who usually go to Antonia's and
absolutely.
Just...
I know the place well, but I will tell you, sir, you had a dance floor. I actually went and inspected. It wasn't, you had the tables, but you also had the dance floor with the singer, so it clearly was marked off for dancing. And I personally, it's a great place. I want to keep it a great place. I happen to like Antonia's, but it seems like the last year, you just have changed things. It's getting loud. The neighbors are complaining. But I think it's great, and I want to see Antonia's. These are the type of places we're looking for on our beach, where people can go my age, go out to dinner, dance. It's a great place. You close early. And it isn't that loud, the music. It's one wing of that building. You're in the driveway. It's that one wing. My son actually lives over one building, and he doesn't hear it. You know, but for those people that do, and actually, I just realized one of them sold because they couldn't put up with that type of noise. And then I appreciate you moving the light. You had bright lights right in the driveway, which, of course, was going in people's windows. And the beach is a beautiful place, but we do have to understand it is also residential. And nothing against Antonio's. I just want them to go by the rules and regulations of their license. It was very simple. And I was very offended when I thought I was being nice explaining to you what the rules were, and that very Friday night you had another time. So I don't know who you've got running these for you, but please show them what your license allows and does not allow. And certainly that door is never to be opened.
We understand, and again, we appreciate the honesty coming forward, the commission. And again, I've explained to my client, I've talked to members of the staff, the entertainment individuals, that the license is not a constitutional right. It is a privilege granted by the city, but we must respect them and the police. My phone is always open. If he has any issues, I told him to call me directly, and I can confer with the board if there's any issues. But again, he is apologetic for any misunderstanding or any issues that were raised during this. He has taken proactive steps to prevent any further incidents. I've explained to my client and also members of the staff, he now has on his smartphone a decibel meter, and it's an application. So what happens is we know the city ordinance is 70. He'll set it at 70, and I've been there at night, you know, trying to walk him through the steps, explaining to him how important it is to keep that noise down, to make sure we're good neighbors, because we're asking the commission for an amended license. We want to make sure that the men and women that live on Revere Beach, this beautiful natural resource, the cleanest water in the United States is in Revere Beach.
Thank you.
I always brag about that.
It's beautiful.
As my grandparents grew up on Revere Beach Parkway, with the Parkway, so as kids, it was clean. Now it's cleanest.
But I will tell you, the problem that the beach has, and you know, and I understand that, we're on the water. Believe it or not, that it bounces off the water, the sound bounces. It's probably not even that loud in there, but it does bounce off the water. We have that with other establishments, and we're constantly going down. You got to close the doors. You got to have to close the windows. But that's just where you are. But it's a beautiful place. I want to see it stay. But I want you to be like you were. I don't know what happened. But last year, the place was beautiful. I was going there to dinner. I mean, it was great. And all of a sudden, I don't know, you're getting some loud music, different entertainment, different, but that door, if you would just keep your door closed, I think that's going to help you out a lot. That side door, like we tell everybody else, those doors, you know, we make them close them at 10 o'clock. And, you know, we know people do, it gets hot. I don't know if you have air conditioning. And it's beautiful to keep the doors and windows open. But, you know, your license is what it is. And I don't want to see the place change. I want it to stay a nice local neighborhood.
Family restaurant, yeah.
And that's what it is. And I have many, many friends. Many of my friends are sitting in the audience, and they love going there. Yeah, and nothing against the place, but the law is the law, and you have to go by your license.
Absolutely, absolutely. We've explained that to him, and he understands.
Sorry. Well, as far as that hearing, I would just like to, unless anybody else has anything to add, I know my colleagues have been down there. If I have nothing else to add, I will table this matter. And should this continue, this matter will be brought up again, and then, of course, there would be sanctions. So I would like to just table it. And
thank you very much. We appreciate that.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you. Move on to the application.
Yeah, now we can go on with the license.
Okay. So this is an application to amend the entertainment license to include widescreen cable TV, jukebox, karaoke, and a vocal and instrumental music and dancing by patrons. Is that correct? Okay. And can...
Again, Attorney Francisi for the Antonia's on the Beach. They personally have a license, I believe, for the disc jockey, the cable TV, the big screen TVs. We're looking to add the karaoke and the dancing.
Right. And so can you give us a little bit of an idea of what you're planning to do to control that process?
Well, again, as Ed mentioned before on the record, once myself and Alex and the music entertainment individuals got together, we explained to them that the commission would be seeking questions how we can maintain the noise level, because this is, we don't want an expansion of the noise and the complaints, puts more pressure on the board and the city. Police have better things to do than monitor this. He has been talking to his staff. If the license is amended and he's allowed to have it, he will be having sort of like Dancing with the Oldies. He'll be having karaoke. We have the decibel meters in place. As Madam Commissioner mentioned, the door will be closed, okay? Everyone will be definitely working together as a cohesive team, almost like a security team, to make sure that patrons are enjoying themselves. And it's going to be a very small 16 by 12 dance floor that it's not out of control. We have one of the entertainers that performs twice a week there, and he sings mostly oldies too, so it's not going to be a heavy metal group or anything like that. It's going to be Sinatra, Billy Joel, a lot of just easy music. As we can see, a lot of our patrons and friends are here in the audience, and they appreciate the fine dining, the family environment of this establishment. But I'll make sure Alex explains also.
So our commitment is to work with the community and with you to make sure that there's no noise, like he said. Keep the door closed all the time. I know the main problem is the door, the back door where handicap is, and that's one of our main concerns, to make sure that the door is always closed down, because that's where the neighbors next to the building complain about the noise. Because most of the time, the main entrance and the windows are completely closed.
So tell me a little bit about management oversight. Is there going to be somebody who will be in charge of the operations if there were a violation or?
I'm there all the time.
You are, so you're always going to be on?
Correct.
So what night? So how many nights a week do you expect to do this?
Usually we're doing Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday.
So 4 days.
Correct.
Okay. And are you applying for 4 days? Is that?
Well, the most days that people dance are basically Friday and Saturday. But we're applying for the karaoke. We do karaoke on Thursdays.
Okay. So,
we just want, when someone goes to the restaurant and they get up from the table and move or dance,
I'm not opposed to that. I think that if run the right way, it makes for an enjoyable atmosphere. So I'm not questioning that. What I want to make sure is that the right controls are in place to manage it. So that's why I want to know, how many nights and what time are you going to be doing that? What time are you starting the events and what time do they end?
Usually 8 o'clock to 11 p.m.
8 to 11?
Correct.
Okay. Do your windows open up in that establishment?
No, they don't.
They don't. Okay.
The front windows, you open the front window.
Just a little, it's like a side window, but no, the whole window won't open, no.
It stays closed. When you say side?
Yes, like a slide, a little slide. But we never open those windows. We don't keep them open. Correct.
You haven't had those windows open this summer?
No, we don't open the windows because
they were never slid open?
Because it's too hot inside and we keep the air conditioning all the time running. So if...
The day I was there, they were open.
No,
they were slid open. And they were, sir. I was there. And the reason being, I never knew they opened. I was surprised when I saw them opened. So they were opened. And all the years I went there, I never even knew they opened.
Well, obviously going forward, when Alex is there, if the license is granted for the extension of the dancing floor and the karaoke, the windows will be closed. Again, as we reiterate, we'll make sure that handicap access door is closed and that he is a good neighbor.
Well, I think the window, he certainly can open the windows, but I think we asked them to close them by 10.
Yeah, we usually keep, I mean, maybe it was a mistake that they did, but we usually keep it closed because we don't want it to get too hot inside. We usually keep the air conditioner running.
We're not telling you to close the windows, open the windows. What we're trying to gather here is we want you to be respectful of the neighbors. If you're going to do 11 o'clock, to me, 11 o'clock's too late to have the windows open if you're going to have karaoke. So, you know, we would like to see them closed earlier than that on those nights. That's all we're saying. I mean, we granted a license similar to that in another establishment, and, you know, the only stipulation that we had was we wanted the windows closed at 10 o'clock. You know, people, you know, even in the summertime, I think that's reasonable. I mean, people don't want to be listening to music at 11 o'clock at night.
Unless it's their own.
Yeah, exactly.
But to answer Madam Commissioner's question also regarding being a good neighbor is many times that I've been in there, either with my parents or family members, as we know, the state police at 10 o'clock wants everyone off the beach. They have a huge parking lot.
You're lucky you have parking.
Yeah, and then they do, you know, once you get in there around 9, they'll say, you know, get your car off, you know, before there's any problems. So it's a learning process. They're very conscientious. He understands the time, money, and effort expended to answer these, you know, charges. And that, again, he's very apologetic for what happened in the past. But going forward, I think we have a plan and effect where he will be able to be there on a regular basis. He is training the staff. He did explain to the musician. There's one of the musicians present today, and I explained to him about a half hour ago how important it is, you know, if he thinks that it's getting too loud, just to, you know, shut off the music. Because the most important thing is the restaurant. The entertainment is secondary.
So, hey, Maggie, we don't have the application here. The amended entertainment license.
Yeah.
It's on my packet. Anyway, is it 8 to 11, the application? What's the hours?
Well, we can put that.
No.
Okay. Okay. All right, so we have to put that as a motion. Okay. All right, so what you got, Joe?
So they're working for on an 8 to 11. 4 days a week.
Okay.
Any other questions from the commission?
Well, I don't know. He said that the entertainment license, Wednesday through Saturday, is that what you're saying?
Yes, Wednesday through Saturday.
Yeah. I'm just a little surprised. Usually Sunday's a bigger day. They have more music on a Sunday, don't they? We usually give out the license Thursday through Sunday.
Currently, we do. I mean, our idea is to do it like Wednesday through Saturday.
Yeah. Oh, that's up to you. I mean, that doesn't.
Yeah.
You know, it's your license. You know, if you want it to Sunday, I have no problem. But obviously, you have to go by.
Well, we get it Sunday. You never know. It would be great too. You know.
So right now, you're applying for Wednesday through Saturday.
Yeah,
correct.
Just Wednesday through
Saturday. 8 p.m. to 11 p.m. Good?
Correct.
Great. Okay. So when windows will be closed at 10. If you decide you're going to open the windows, that's your call at the end of the day. But we'd like to see them closed at 10.
Correct. It'll be closed by 10.
That's acceptable to you?
Absolutely.
Fine. Any other questions from the commission?
The only thing I was questioning was the instrumentals. How many pieces? I think he has a license. What is your license now for your pieces, instrumental pieces?
Four.
Yeah. What is the size of your band? Our entertainers.
Four musicians.
No. Four?
Yeah.
This is talking about.
Don't forget to cut that down. Thank you.
No direct amplification instruments such as.
Electric guitar.
Yeah. So you thought no. No direct amplification instruments such as electric guitars. So this is going to be all acoustic? Is that what you're telling us?
Well, the karaoke is, as you know, they look at...
Yeah, aside from the karaoke. I'm more concerned about the live instruments.
On the live instruments, again, our main entertainer's here. He's telling me that he's usually by himself, maybe one other person.
I'm okay with four. I'm just trying to figure out. It says no amplification. So is it an acoustic set? Is that what we're doing?
There's no amplification.
Okay, that's all I'm asking. Yeah. That's all right by me.
You have to understand. He plays in a band, so
it's okay.
So if that's acceptable, it's no amplification.
Yeah, no amplification.
Okay, I'm fine with that.
Yeah,
good. Any questions?
Sounds good. I have to say, since he's called you, it's funny. They need to get an attorney. Since he's called you, it's been nice and quiet. It's been, you know.
Well, thank you very much.
I just don't understand. We went down and told him you could do the same thing. And actually, I don't understand it. You started in June, and every month you were coming with your application, and you never came with it.
I was really busy, so I couldn't get the time to do it.
Are there any proponents that want to speak on behalf of this establishment?
John Powell's counsel.
Excuse me?
Counsel.
John. Proponents, counselor?
Good afternoon. John Powell, 46 DePonta Street, Revere. As many of you know, several years ago, I came up here opposed to the entertainment license that included bands, floor shows, and dancing. That was a little too much for me. I thought that this could possibly turn in, with that type of a venue, this could possibly turn into something like the Lido down on the Boulevard, and I was 100% against that.
As are we.
Yeah, and I appreciate that. Most of the restaurants you go to now seem to be featuring music for dancing by patrons. That seems to be an attraction, not only there, but throughout other localities in the city. The only thing I would absolutely hope you would insist upon is that door being closed so it doesn't affect the condominium units next door, number one. And number two, that the dance floor be restricted to the footage, the dimensional footage.
I'm sorry, say that again.
The dance floor be restricted to the dimensional footage.
Right.
That was mentioned earlier, which I had a discussion with the attorney on. Because again, I don't want to see this turn into a dance hall or anything like that.
Agreed.
And certainly the limit on the musicians that they're allowed to have there. I don't want to see, you know, a big band coming in there.
Yep.
Other than that, I would be, I'm opposed to, I'm in favor of it. I'm opposed to any other incident, any other condition that would make this, larger than it currently is. I think that it's a good business. They're trying hard down there, as most of the businesses on the Boulevard. We're trying to going to be constructing a 234 apartments, probably within 300 feet of that. And that's going to be a plus for the beach and the city. And I would like to see that there'd be more places like Antonia's on that Boulevard where people can go and enjoy dinner and enjoy dancing and maybe a night out. Thank you.
Great, thank you.
Well, Council, that's exactly what we're trying to do here, is keep it a beach, keep it a restaurant and dancing. And I know a lot of these people that are here, I think it's great, I'm glad that they come. But so many times, I want to warn you people, so many times, we've given out licenses to great people, they run great businesses, and then they want karaoke, they want live bands, they want that, and because they're good neighbors, we give them a license, and in a year they sell. And then we're stuck with a Lido, we're stuck with the Wonderland Ballroom. And that's why we're very cautious about what we do with our licenses. It's not anti-business, it's not anti-Antonio's or any other business. It's to keep it, no matter who buys the building, they will have to stay by these rules and regulations. But this, he could be a great guy, and like you say, a lot of character's been talked about. But it doesn't mean these characters are going to be there forever.
No,
if you give these big licenses out, you're going to live with what we've had on Revere Beach in the past.
I've been in there several times myself. I frequent the place, and what I see in there most of the time are senior citizens like myself who are just out for dinner and a night of entertainment and dancing. Thank
there
you.
Isn't many places for us to go
All
anymore.
Right.
That's
okay, so any other things you'd like to add, Councilor?
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any other proponents? Proponents? Proponents.
Those in favor.
Those in favor.
Yes.
I just want to say one thing, Linda, when you mentioned the dance floor. If you have four couples up on that floor, possibly five, it's crowded.
Absolutely.
You know that.
I know.
That back door, well, I personally have never seen it open. I have seen the windows open during the day, but never at night.
Well, they weren't open. They were open.
During the I never saw them at nighttime, but during the day I have, you know, let the.
But you and I know. Listen, you and I live the beach area.
I know.
You and I know when these licenses were given.
Exactly.
What happened to them?
But this is such a nice place. You can go with your family.
Wonderful.
It's terrific. It really is.
And that's what we're trying to keep it.
Good.
As it is now, without changes.
Thank you.
Dancing is fine. The only reason he didn't have dancing all summer is because we asked him on several times to apply. And he never did.
You know, I've never seen a band. I don't know where this four-piece bands are coming up. I know the singer there, he's just usually alone.
There used to be six there. So.
I never saw it.
Any other things you'd like to add, ma'am?
I never saw it.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Any other proponents? Please state your name and address for the record, please.
This is the singer.
I know.
Bo Howard, Andover, Massachusetts. I'm the entertainment and I like to work there for a long time, so please give us a job. Because the floor, the people are very nice there. The acoustics is probably one of the best acoustics in the area. And when I go to perform, sing, it's like the greatest thing. The sounds, I think I sound good there. Any other place, I sound horrible. Not really. But I appreciate the opportunity to perform for them. I'm not a public speaker, but I can't sing. I sing well.
Great.
So I can't talk to you without probably some things in my voice, nervousness or whatever. But I love singing for the people there. They are all ages, but mostly a mature crowd. And I promised myself that I would keep the level of the music at a place where
Great.
You would enjoy it. And
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is there any more I can say?
That's it. Any other proponents? Any other proponents? Those who want to speak in favor of?
The only thing ladies and gentlemen of the commission, the only thing I would add is State Representative Rosalie Vincent, who represents the 16th Suffolk, was kind enough to write a letter of support. I'd like to introduce that as an exhibit on behalf of the applicant.
Great, thank you. Last call on proponents. Hearing and seeing none, I'll close that side. Are there any opponents? Those against? Hearing and seeing none, I'll close that. I'll make a motion to approve this based on 8 to 11, Wednesday to Saturday night. Windows closed by 10 p.m. The door closed at all times. Dance floor limited to 16 by 12 as agreed to with the Council of Powers, and no amplification on the entertainment. Is that correct, Council?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second the motion.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Good luck.
Thank you very
Thanks.
Much. And I also want to personally thank Maggie for all her excellent work.
I'm sure.
I put her in for a raise.
Counselor, your crowd is out of order already. All right, item number 11. Item number 11 is 388 Broadway LLC doing business as Volaris. This is a hearing concerning possible violations of licensing laws and regulations related to control of premises in service to intoxicated patrons. Yeah, we before I have Valaris come up, I'd like to have the police department address some of the concerns. Excuse me, back there, please.
Where's your hammer?
I don't know. Give my hammer. I'd like to have the police department come up and address some of the concerns that they see and the reason why we've brought you here before the commission. Please state your name and position at the police department, please.
Officer Fantasia with Revere Police Department. We have I'm going to defer to Officer Nick Fantasia, works the night shift, and he's a frequent responder to the calls at Valari's.
Great, thank you.
So for the last several years, I've been assigned to the one sector of Revere, which includes the Broadway area and Park Ave, where the establishment is. Throughout the last several years, we've had numerous issues. And none of these issues take place during the times of like restaurant hours. This is usually a Thursday, Friday, Saturday night issue after 9, 10 p.m. with more of a bar crew than a restaurant issue. The last major issue we had there was just an altercation out front. At the direction of my lieutenant, the patrol supervisor, he had asked me to compose a list just for 2016. So this was on the 30th of July. He asked me to compose a list of an in-house record of all the times we've been to Valari's for more than a directed patrol. On the night shift, we do directed patrols of all the establishments to include anything that serves liquor. Sit out front their establishment, FIO people, make sure everybody's getting home safe, things like that. With the exception of those, since January of 2016, up to date as of today, we've been there 13 times for different types of disturbances. Out of those 13, four have been arrests. Two were major assaults that took place. The other major issue is not only with the service calls, we've had 13 service calls for a bar like that in less than almost a half a year by July. The other major issue we have is patrol. Is the last incident I had there, we were on a directed patrol, two marked cruisers with lights on. There's several people that congregate outside the establishment to smoke cigarettes, to talk, discuss. And you guys are all familiar with the area. It's not a quiet area, even at 2 o'clock in the morning, traffic-wise. There's buses that ride until, I believe, 1:30, 1:15 a.m. There's traffic up and down Broadway all night long, and the major concern is the people that congregate outside leads to issues, whether it's due to over-serving or due to just general intoxication. They're at a bar, and altercations occur out front of the bar, and that's been the major issue for the last couple months, and I'd say probably the last 2 years. Other than that, I have notes on my phone.
It's okay.
Sorry, excuse me for 1 second, everything's on my phone. So we have issues with parking there as well. And this isn't during restaurant hours. This is 11 o'clock p.m., 10 o'clock p.m. There's several parking spots out front of the establishment on Broadway. The problem is they also, I'm not sure if they have an agreement with Citizens Bank across the street. There's several people that park over there. As far as that goes, Citizens Bank's a private establishment. We don't do parking control inside their parking lot. But the problem we have is people leave the restaurant, cross the street against the lights. Intoxicated people in traffic at nighttime is definitely an issue. It's not a well-lit area. We've had numerous car breaks back there just because there's so many cars there at 2 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the morning. Along with that, the other issue we have is the smokers out front, the parking, the type of clientele that is going there from the 10 p.m. time on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, is the crowd that we all know as police officers and patrolmen. They're known gang members, known drug users. This is an issue, and it's nothing that they're doing to bring that in there, but it's an issue. And it's been to an issue where you guys, it's led to numerous assaults. Every time we go there, it happens to be outside the establishment, which they're still coming from that establishment. It might not happen inside their restaurant, might not happen at their bar, but it's patrons of their bars. It's people that are walking all over Park Ave until 2 o'clock, 2:30 in the morning. That come from there. So it's a problem of over-serving. It's a problem of what do we do with the smokers. It's a problem of parking. The MBTA has complained to me personally several times. There's two spots. I spoke to management there before in the past, asked them not to park there. I try not to give parking tickets. It's just something I don't enjoy doing as a police officer. it's still an issue. Parking in illegal spots, the buses can't make the turns, therefore they call and complain to us. We rectify it by giving tickets that night, and then a week later it happens again. The other complaint we have is the 7 Park Ave and 30 Park Ave building behind them can hear music. We get several complaints and calls. People are outside, they're loud, it's 2:30 in the morning, whether it's from their live music or from, I don't believe they have a DJ, or they do play loud music if it's a DJ, I'm not sure. It's just an overcrowding, overserving, and the outside is a major issue for us.
Great, thank you. Any other things you'd like to?
No, like I just said, I just want to make it known that since 2016, we've been there for 13 times, and four have been arrests.
Do you currently have a detail there on Saturdays?
We have a detail, I believe, Friday and Saturday.
Friday and Saturday nights, yes.
And the detail is there from what, when?
10:30 to 2:30.
And do you find that helps?
Yeah, it absolutely helps.
Does it help outside the establishment, though?
Well, here's the problem. It's one officer. I'm not sure what the capacity is, but there's at least 30 people in front of him. He's inside working with their security, and I do want to make it known that the management did hire a new security company, I'm not sure when, but recently, and it has made a little bit of an increase, a little bit of a difference. But the problem is they have 3 entry points. They only use 2, or they try to use just 1, but people kind of do whatever they want when these guys are trying to also manage. So it's hard to keep a control on that. And as one officer detail, you can't control the outside in the street and control inside. So as patrolmen, you're taking 2 patrolmen off to do corrective patrols there. We're clearing out the sidewalk. We're doing this. Well, the detail officer is inside. So now you have 2 patrolmen for a city of only 7 cops. 2 of us are tied up there clearing out their establishment at 2:30 when the detail's inside helping. Or before that, I would say between 1:30 and 2 o'clock, the detail's assigned to the inside of the building. They're pushing people out. 1:45, 2 o'clock, there's 30 people on the sidewalk of Park F.
Would 2 officers be better?
It could help.
I mean, do you think it would protect, do you think it would eliminate the problems of people entering or exiting a second doorway?
It could. And to be honest with you, sir, I don't work that detail. I work the overnight shift, so I'm not frequent enough there to work that detail. So as the patrol officer, I don't know if that would help, but I would assume 4 eyes are better than 2 at that point. But like I said, honestly, I think the major issue is controlling somehow, and I don't know how, I don't even have a recommendation, controlling, one, maybe a clothing policy to keep specific types of behavior out of the establishment. And along with that, an area where they can work on corralling the smokers and keeping everybody confined to a certain area so there's not people all the way up to the new school or behind the establishment, some Revere House of Pizza and Peter Wu's behind there. So I'm not sure if another detail will help. I'm sure that if there's more than one cop, it's always helpful. Maybe a guy can work outside, one can work inside. I'm not sure.
Great, thanks.
Would you attribute this to over-serving?
So according to I have several reports in front of me. We can get you more detailed logs. Several of the logs are, you know, respond to assist an intoxicated female or intoxicated male out front of the establishment. And it's never inside, but it's always directly in front or in front of the jewelry box. I'm sorry, the jewelry store next door or in front of the fire station. It's never directly inside, but it's always almost like they made it outside and now it's our problem.
Now, does anyone from the establishment come out when they're breaking and watch that they move along?
Just recently, since they hired a new security, it's a new company, I believe, they hired. And he does go outside, the gentleman, but they also don't get too involved because they say it's kind of on us. That's what I've heard from the security department there, which I can see that they don't want to get in an altercation on the street, but.
Now, when you say you have detail, do they do detail inside and out? If you were to get detail from the police department, maybe, can you get detail to hire one for outside and one for inside? Do they do it that way?
At some point, it's going to become a game of numbers, because if I looked at the records, this detail isn't filled 100% of the time. So if we can't fill it with one guy 100% of the time, the chances that we're going to be able to fill it with 2 are going to be even less.
Is that a function of manpower, or is it a function of people don't want to do it?
A little bit of both. I mean, yeah, you know, there are, you know, the details are obviously optional, so there are certain types of details that, you know, officers want to work, and there's certain types of details that officers don't want to work. Not every officer wants to work a bar detail. Myself included.
Yeah. Right.
Sometimes those bar details aren't the easiest thing for us to work, especially coming off the shift and stuff like that. So, and I'm not sure that two officers there is going to rectify the problem. I think that even with two officers there, the problem is it's a smaller establishment. There's a lot of people in there. It's a lot of frequent of the same people and the same clientele that they're coming there, whether they're already intoxicated when they get in there, overserved. It's a problem of alcohol.
Do you think that, you're not there, you say you don't work, and maybe it's a question for the owner, that they're letting people in there late for last call, 1 o'clock? Usually when we have problems like that consistently, they're letting late comers in that have already been drinking elsewhere, and then they serve them again.
Yeah. So my shift starts at midnight. So we usually do directed patrols between 1 and 2. I usually get there around 1:30. They do a good job of stopping the door, but a lot of the crowds here, because now we're a 2 o'clock licensed city, they do come between that 12:30 and 1:30 period to get last call. So it's definitely an issue.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Could you address those issues? One of the problems that I, you know, obviously the police department is bringing it to the commission's attention, and although I haven't personally experienced that, I have been in there, you know, for dinner like around 10 o'clock at. And you could notice a significant difference in the clientele, because I'm in there at 7 o'clock, and I recognize 10 o'clock's a little bit later, but I went in there with my family at 10 o'clock, and you notice it, and I'm trying to figure out, of all the establishments we have in the city, we've had a couple that have had some issues, and we've taken, you know, action to roll back the time. I mean, obviously that's your livelihood. That's, you know, something that we want to do as a last resort. But having said that, even some of the worst establishments that we've had to take action on doesn't have anywhere near the amount of incidents that you have. And some of them are pretty serious. I mean, you know, somebody getting hit with a shot glass in the middle of the restaurant, which was one that we brought you here, but, you know, way back when, you know, you've been able to, it seems like you've been able to curb some of that, not all of it based off the reports that we've read, but I'd like to know what do you think the reason is that that happens, that, you know, you get a change from really what I view as a family restaurant into you know, a bar, and not one that goes without any incidents. Like I said, I don't think we want to be here. I certainly don't want to be here and have to take action against somebody that's going to hurt them in their wallets. But by the same token, you know, I don't think I'd want to go in there with my family at 11 o'clock and have to worry about getting involved in the middle of some type of scuffle. Can you address that?
I understand your position, and we are a neighborhood establishment. We employ over 30 persons, so it's our livelihood. Not only do we live off it, but the families that we employ, we take our business seriously. We hope to be here, you know, until God takes us. We try everything in our power to do what's right. We stopped serving in glasses after 10 o'clock. We start using plastic. We started implementing a dress code so that no caps, no saggy pants. We're trying to have or wean out the problematic patrons. At the door, our detail does a phenomenal job in checking.
You're talking about your security?
Both. We have two doormen, and we have our police, our Revere police detail, that comes in at 10:30. He's our eyes at the front door. If they see that someone's already intoxicated, they won't allow them to enter the premises. They check IDs to make sure we're not serving anyone underage. We're trying our hardest to wean out the problematic clients. And even our security knows that if this person had an altercation here before, they're never allowed back in.
When did you hire security?
We started that back in, after the last hearing. April, when were we here last? Whenever we were here last, we hired two new people, along with our detail that comes in Friday and Saturday.
Officer Fantasia, would you say that, that incidents went down from the time that they hired their security?
Since then, there's been three other incidents since then. So,
since July?
Since July.
There's been three.
So they're just minor stuff, but they're involved in transport of a TK female. I have the case numbers here. I'm not sure what they're about, but I know that they were disturbance calls. 99 and 806 for three disturbance calls since then. So,
what times were those? Any idea?
They were all past 10 o'clock. I know that because when I did my search, I eliminated anything prior to 10 p.m. I don't have it on here. I just hand wrote it. It was last minute.
Yeah. Great.
So,
thank you.
And then, can I just make one comment, too? We had a major incident there when one of the employees were assaulted in the rear of the establishment, and it turned out to an arrest. Not only for that assault, but an arrest for a disorderly intoxicated male party that I dealt with personally, heavily intoxicated, came out of that establishment. And there were several groups of people involved with that. I spoke to security myself and management about those people involved. And since then, I've seen them there myself after talking to people and asking them not to go back there. And it's not on the police department to do trespasses. We can't trespass someone from a private establishment that's on the establishment. So to say that they don't let people in there that has been involved in altercations, or not the stem of altercations, but still involved, doesn't seem to be a fair statement.
Great. Thank you. I mean, I find it hard to dispute all the incidents that, I mean, you can't dispute all the incidents that have taken place. I think one of the things that is concerning to me is that you've taken steps and it still hasn't changed. I mean, even after the fact that we've added a detail officer and now you've got two security people, and I mean, to me, I'm more concerned about something very seriously, you know, serious happening out there. I mean, we've gotten complaints from the residents, and now the police department, and the fact that the police department has been documenting this thing really leads me to believe that, you know, you need to take much stronger controls, and I'm not even sure if 2 a.m. is a good time. I mean, I can't roll you back to 10 p.m. Because it looks like it starts after that. I mean, the sad part about the whole thing is it's a great restaurant. I mean, you know, I go there on many occasions. You know, the food's terrific. And I've just never seen a restaurant that has, you know, that good a reputation for being a restaurant turn into that kind of place after 10 o'clock. And like I said to you, I've seen it firsthand. I've been in there, you know. I haven't been in there when there's been any incidents, but I can certainly tell you that there's a significant difference. It's a lot louder, and it seems like it's a lot more aggressive than when you're sitting in there at 8 o'clock. I'd like to hear from you, and I'm not sure what the solution is at this point, but I'd like to know what you're planning to do to rectify these problems, because it can't continue to the way it's going.
Since we received the notice in reference to this hearing, that's when we changed our dress policy, that we decided, okay, this is, you know, gotten out of hand, and I would have addressed it even sooner if the police department had told me or came to us and said, listen, you know, you're having too many incidents or this is going on, we would have addressed it even sooner. But we have officers that come in for dinner, that come in for drinks all the time, and they say how great we are and how this and that. So I
yeah, but
would...
you can't. But you can't. I mean, I can notice the difference, and I don't run a restaurant. And it's not his responsibility to make sure that you know your patrons are doing the right thing. You know, your bartenders, you know, should be tip certified. They should be able
they
to.
They all are.
I understand, but it doesn't seem like they're identifying people who are intoxicated. I mean, I'm not tip certified, but I can tell you, I can walk in and tell you who's intoxicated and who's not.
Right.
You know, like I said to you, I'm not, please state your name for the record, please.
Salvador Gagno, I'm the chef at Volare, and I usually leave it, we have this discussion before, I usually leave it after dinner time, and it's 11 o'clock. This is when we start have a change in music from Frank Sinatra to 87th, whatever. And about this incident about intoxicated, I was present over there, that some people come already intoxicated from over there, and we're not allowed to get in. That's why come the chaos outside, because like the people that want to get in, and we're not allowed there. So this is the other stuff that we did when we get called the last time over here to call right away 911, and that's why they have many phone calls from, even for us, that we cannot serve.
I mean, I can.
Any people already intoxicated.
Yeah, I mean, so, I can appreciate that to some degree. I recognize that if you're going to change procedures and people are going to come, it's going to take a while to get them acclimated to they're not getting in because they're intoxicated. But we're talking from April now to almost mid-September, and it hasn't changed.
Because of the way you say, like, it changes, like, it kind of type crowd, you know, and this is what we can, when we have this type
well,
crowd.
Well, we're talking almost 6 months, right?
Perfectly, but whatever they ask us to adjust it, it was the certificate, all the bartender put a police detail for Friday and Saturday, change the glasses, you know, make sure that we have two to security. So we used to have one, so we hired another one. You know, so
well, I'm not saying you're not taking steps to help.
To interrupt you, the way that I hear the, all the accident and incidents up and outside, and all the time after the time frame of the how operation after 2 o'clock to 2:30, so it's so hard to direct the traffic in, for us even outside because it's normal. Even if we would say not 30 people. Was it not even 20 people here, you gotta say, be quiet, because they make a noise. For
I understand
us too,
that.
We get a,
I understand
a quarter to two, 25 people, 30 people out. I think it's normal they're gonna make a noise, and the way you say, is it car, is the bus, is every half an hour come, you know. What other suggestion you give it to us, believe me, I wanna keep my job.
Yeah, no, I get that, but by the same token, we have other establishments, they still roll out at 2 a.m., occasionally, we get a call. They've made some changes outside the establishment. You know, for the most part, you know, I think it's gone pretty well based off of the number of establishments we have. But this one continues to be a problem. I mean, it's.
I would think that, honestly, if I were to look at these reports, probably with all of the bars in our city. You've had the most calls, putting them all together. And they all leave at 2 o'clock, and there's bigger clubs than yours. You actually have a very small restaurant, so I'm surprised. I don't understand how you can't control that. And again, it's tying up our tax dollars, it's tying up the police department. There are other things going on in our city, and we can't police someone's business. You should know, I mean, without someone telling you, that's like in my home. I don't need someone outside to tell me what's going on. That's your business. You should know what's going on. And to me, it's unacceptable. Unacceptable. I can't believe you're back here again. And I don't know what to say other than roll your hours back. And I mean, as far as the bank, parking at the bank, maybe the bank should take a look because they've got a liability problem there too. And they should probably put up some chains so that they can't park there. But I think that's going to hurt your business.
There's a public parking base or lot, I should say, right behind Citizens Bank. So I don't think that it should affect us that much, only because of that public parking.
But again, if they're leaving your place intoxicated, now you're right on top of homes in that area.
Right.
It's got to, the problem's got to stop right at your place is where it's got to stop. And I understand they leave your building, but you know, most of our incidents, they come out of an establishment. Yeah, well, they might be outside, but I can tell you it came from the inside out.
So on 419, you had combatants, people that were in the bar that you know, were removed from the bar, ended up back in the bar after the fact, okay? 1240, on 415, there were a couple arguing outside of the establishment. On 4:30 at 9:20 p.m., drunk female transported to the Widen. Okay, on 5:21, major brawl in the citizens' parking lot. Okay, this is at closing time for you. 6:04, 2 a.m. disturbance at Valari's. 7:07, 12:30, Valari's called two women to be removed from the establishment. 7:10, 12:40 p.m. Directed patrol handled an assault at Valari's. 7:17, 12 a.m., fight outside of Valari's. I mean, there isn't an establishment in the city that has this. And I'm not even done. I don't even want to go through the effort of doing the others, but the point I'm trying to make is that it's a major problem. I mean, you can't see that?
No, I can. I'm sorry, I can. It's not that I don't see it. It's that I think that we're trying to do everything that we should do. I thought we were on the right path to control the noise, to make sure we're running a decent place. We closed the side door the one that goes out to our neighbors on the right-hand side, so no one can come in or out. Well, they can go out, but they can't come in that door after 10 o'clock so that people could only use the main door. As far as the fights go, you're right. How do I control two women from arguing? That's kind of tough, and unfortunately,
maybe it starts with serving.
That's fine, and I agree with you. Okay, that's fine. We're going to keep a closer look or a closer eye on our employees to make sure that they're not over-serving and what's going on. But in part, I also see that alcohol raises everybody's blood pressure, and you know, certain times it leads to incidents and arguments.
It does,
but I will try. I will talk to everyone on our staff, and now we're going to have to really monitor how many drinks each patron is served. And again, our doormen do a great job in trying to keep people from coming in. After one, we don't allow anyone in. They try to make sure that no one comes in intoxicated, because that's the other thing, that yes, people from other bars or other places want to come in, and so we want to avoid all those problems.
But we had a 1 o'clock closing, you know, for several years. I think you remember we had the 1 o'clock closing.
Yeah.
This board extended it to 2 o'clock, and I have to tell you, we haven't had a problem. We haven't had a problem. You say you're closing your doors at 1 o'clock. Everyone else in the city is doing the same thing, and we don't have a problem. I haven't seen a difference, and I was one that was for a rollback of 1 o'clock. But since it's gone to 2 o'clock, I still haven't seen any difference. Every establishment is abiding by the rules, and they are getting people off the board. You just heard the hearings here. They're out, and there's no problems. It's your staff, and my commissioner said, you can tell if a problem's arising. Two girls are sitting at a bar and you're still serving them. You can tell if something is erupting. You stop it then and you ask them to leave. So I, you know, honestly, to police your bar, that's not our job. That's your license. Right. And as far as the police department, sure, I'm sure they go in there and eat, and it's wonderful to go in to eat. But it doesn't mean that they don't see your problems. But that's up to you. It is your license. But I'm shocked at what's going on there.
I will take any recommendation that you or the police department will make. I will implement them immediately. What else can I do, or what should I do?
I think there's a few solutions. I think that if you can't control the patrons you have there, maybe we have to cut down on your capacity. you know, I don't know what your capacity is right now. Maybe there's too many people coming in. That's going to hurt you.
See, the common data points, the common stuff is the hours or the time these things are happening, and that's after 12.
Right.
That's the common point. So if you eliminate anything, your occupancy from 12, maybe that stuff goes away. I mean, officer, there's a good chance it would go.
There's a good chance it could happen, like I said. Like I said, during restaurant hours, when that's a great establishment, there's no issues. You don't go there on Tuesday night at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
Going there Friday, Saturday, past 10:30, 12 o'clock.
Yeah. All of these 10 or 12 are based on 12:30 on. So my point is, you pull those hours availability out, the number goes down to one or two incidences. So the only thing that we can do here to make that happen is to pull your hours back to 12. And I'm sure you don't want that.
Mm.
However, I see no other. You guys do everything you can in your power, but you know, people are people. We can't control human beings and what they do, especially when they have a few drinks. But the thing we can't control is the hours of operation.
Right.
So depending on my colleagues, on where we stand with that, I have no problem being able to pull some hours for a few months and see if the data changes. If it still happens before 12, then something else is going on. I don't know, Linda and Joe have to say about that.
Well, you came into our city as a restaurant, and it's wonderful. I wouldn't say anything about that restaurant. I think it's great, but when it comes to tying up our police department and actually putting them in danger, as you say, you know, they don't know what they're going to face. People are out there intoxicated. There's 20 or 30 of them, and we've got one police officer showing up. That's a danger to our city, and it's tying up valuable men that can be around our city, taking care of other issues. So I personally think it's a great restaurant. I think it's wonderful. But I think when you switch from a restaurant to a bar, you've got your problems. And I don't think you can handle that well.
There's some communities that if you're not serving food, you're not serving liquor. I mean, I don't know if that should be the case here. But you can certainly make a case off of it based off your track record at the moment.
Well, if it's turning into just a pouring bar, then yes, there's your problem. What time does the kitchen close?
11:30.
Okay, we close 11 o'clock, 11:30 on Friday and Saturday, and we have a late night menu to provide people.
Right, appetizers, pizza. Usually around midnight, we give pizza.
Free pizza to make sure that everybody here has some drink. Get some energy back, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Do you think a second detail officer would eliminate some strain on the officer that was there?
Yeah, it could always help. I mean, I don't see how two officers can make it any worse. I'm not saying that it's going to make it 100% better either.
I
don't really have a recommendation.
I recognize it. And I don't want to put you in that position either, obviously.
I've talked to the owner myself. Like I said, I'm the sector car. I'm not the type of guy that just doesn't acknowledge this stuff. We've talked several times in the past, and I've tried to help implement ideas, and we've tried. And at this point, I don't know what else they could try to make it better. Will two detail officers help? I can't see why it wouldn't help. I can't say that it's going to rectify the problem altogether. And like the lieutenant said, it's the summertime. We all have other things going on, and a lot of times we can't even fill the one detail.
Yeah.
One of the issues there too, and we've spoke to the manager about it before, some things get lost in translation. There's 100 of us, sometimes someone will cancel a detail. If he doesn't have a detail, he needs to call us to let us know, hey, no one showed up, and we can get someone down there if need be, or at least inform the sector cars. There's no detail at Valari tonight, so make sure you respond from Valari, answer your calls from outside, which the lieutenants will do. So he's going to make sure he does call us if there is no detail. Two details could definitely help.
How often would you say that the detail officer, where you have an opening and they're not in
that's above
my... I think Lieutenant Randall handles that.
Yeah, I checked with the detail officer. We weren't able to pull the records today because he wasn't in, but just talking to him, a couple of times a month, they're unable to fill the
really?
Detail.
That much?
So,
like
I said, I don't know that usually, as you members on the board know, usually when a bar has a problem and they're forced to have a detail, most of the time that rectifies the problems. It hasn't seemed to rectify the problem here, so I don't know if putting another officer is gonna be the answer.
If we have to get another security guy for outside, it can be not a solution. We can get another security guy from outside.
Right, if we hire someone, yes, but truthfully, if I had to hire another detail, we couldn't afford it. Realistically, we can't afford it.
I mean, my only response to that would be if you can't be doing that, then, you know, I'd be inclined to roll back the hours to 1 a.m. and see how that goes. I obviously don't want to do that. I mean, this is your livelihood. I don't want to be sitting here having to police your business, but obviously, you know, it is a problem.
I'm not saying I'll hire another doorman if I have to. You know, as much as I'd love to give the city of Revere the business, but it's costly. It costs us, it's $1,000 every 2 weeks. And that's, so if I add another police officer, it's just really, we can't afford it. So but it's cheaper for me if I hire, you know, another security person to either, you know, police the outside, or not police, but, you know, to help us with the outside. But I think with the changes that we started since I got this notice, as far as the dress code, I think that's going to change a lot as far as the type of patrons that are coming in on a Friday night. I think that really is going to change. I don't think you've received any calls or incidents from us for the last maybe month or month and a half.
9:15.
Please state your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Chris Salerno. I live at 175 Carter Street in Chelsea. Just about the calls to the cops, I've made several calls, and I've instructed my employees to make several calls. So a lot of those calls could be from me. I'm not sure.
I like, you know what I mean?
Sure. I don't want to
make that known that these guys are calling. But like, regardless of the calling, it's still intoxicated patrons that we're dealing with from inside your establishment.
Well, sometimes people walk in and, you know, they can come in before the security, like 9:30, 10, and we'll not serve them. You know what I mean? And we don't want to have a bad confrontation. So if we think there's going to be a confrontation, we'll call the cops, you know, for every little thing. I told them.
And that's good. I mean, we don't want to discourage you from that either.
Yeah, no, I call all the time.
Too. Yeah, and I don't want to talk about
security. You don't want high security costs $1,000. What do you think it's costing the city to have police? So yeah, you're getting free police. We've got police cruisers tied up there every night. I also
asked the police detail, you know, give me a list of known gang members, known people that you know. Because I'm an East Boston guy. I'm not a Revere guy. So I really don't know everybody in the area. You know what I mean? I know a lot of people, but not everybody. So I ask them all the time, who's good, who's bad? Like, who do you want me to kick out? They'll be gone for life. You know, I don't mind. I don't want those people. We don't need their business.
I would think you would be able to spot them when they walk in. Usually you can see the
troublemakers. I'm a very nice guy. I like people from all walks of life. I'm not very like...
Well, when we talk police, I'm a little sensitive to that. That's tax dollars.
I have a million cop friends. I have so many cop friends, especially since opening the restaurant.
The taxpayers don't want to leave it to police.
I mean, I'm a taxpayer too. I understand.
That's advantageous. Those last three calls in September, were they just general?
General disturbance calls. So okay, nothing. Unless it requires a report. None of them required a report.
Some of the things that they're instituting, I mean, outside those calls, right, are starting to take effect.
Like, I'll see drug addicts on the corner, I'll call. Get them out of here. You know what I mean? I don't like the way it looks out there. You know what I mean? I'll call for every little thing.
We're all on the same page. The 13 incidents I do have in front of me, I read through myself, and it wasn't that situation of dealing with the local Broadway.
No, because I instruct.
At 3 o'clock in the morning in front of Walgreens, we have issues.
Oh, yeah, no question.
That's a whole separate issue altogether. And working next sector for almost 5 years, I know the difference of people who were either patients or someone who is frequenting behind Walgreens.
And I'd like to ask, you know, since everyone's here now, I'd like to ask them, you know, if you want, give me a list of people, and I'll just for life, they'll never be able to walk in there.
That's the police department involved. I'll do that.
Well, I'm just saying, I don't know. I mean,
another thing I want to say for the end. One day I had a police cruise come to the restaurant. And I said, I heard there's a fight.
I say, we don't call nobody, there's no fight over there. So practically the people call, and because we are Volare in Broadway, everybody's like, is in Volare. All of a sudden I see somebody coming from the other restaurant, I don't want to name it, whatever, say, oh yeah, I saw people fight across the street from the fire department and citizen. But of course, like, what am I going to happen? And they find them out.
I get that, and that happens, but let's also be honest and say that you know, obviously at some point things changed, and there's more incidents there, and there's more people coming out of there.
Well, I can tell you personally, it's definitely been tapering off. I believe that, you know what I mean. From those bad incidents to now, it's just
all right. Well, just, you know, for full disclosure here, you know, it seemed like the consensus here was roll back hours for you, and see how that went. You know, we can try, one, I want if a detail isn't there, I want somebody at the establishment to make a call and notify the police department of that, number one.
Absolutely.
You could try extra security. I don't know if it's better to put the officer out on the corner.
Well, I will definitely state, since they hired private security, which would be after the incident with the glass, they hired security. He has helped with the situation.
Okay.
But, I mean, the situation seems to be stable. I wouldn't say it's getting better or worse. It's stable. I mean, this...
Well, stable's not good enough, though.
Right.
Quite honestly.
Like I said, I'm just here because I was told to write a report on what I observe on a nightly basis.
And so, Mr. Chairman, they were put on notice after the last meeting to call when the detail was not there. And obviously from
what here,
that's not happening.
Oh, that was stated here that we had a call? I didn't hear that. Or
all right, so
that,
so
they,
that
they were told,
but yeah,
they,
no,
they
I will call. I mean,
so what I would suggest is that and maybe we try it for a 30-day trial. We'll let you can hire the additional security. Maybe we put the officer outside versus inside. I don't know. That's your call.
Yeah, I would have to say that you have to the officer, depending on the crowd.
That's your call.
I mean, you can't say be fine outside if there's 40 people. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Whatever.
You determine that from.
That's your call.
The evening.
Okay.
I have to be concerned. I'm a little concerned. I know. You're going to make a motion, but...
No, not yet, but...
I think I'm more concerned that this is the only bar that I've heard that at a certain hour has to go to plastic. What does that tell you in itself of your patrons, that you have to have plastic?
Yeah, I guess I mean...
The plastic was the suggestion that we get from here because of the incident.
Right.
I'll be honest with you, the incident with
the
glass,
there were
two women, two girls... And the girls, I would never, ever, ever, ever picture them fighting. You know what I mean? And they just had some, you know, past little thing.
Well, this is a tough business.
Thing.
You know, alcohol.
I could never see
business.
Them doing that. And these girls, they weren't like real bad girls. Like, they're well known in the city. They're actually good people. Like, I fundraised for one of them for the marathon. Like, she runs the marathon. You know what I mean? I couldn't believe it. It was like.
So how long have you started implementing these new systems? It's been.
The plastic was after the last hearing.
The last 30 days, the other stuff, you know, the dress code.
We have a bunch of stuff. I wrote down a bunch of stuff.
Right, the dress code, we started as soon as we received this notification. So we started about 3 weeks ago, give or take. Right, no hat, no saggy pants, right. The dress code was implemented about 3 weeks ago. The not coming in after 1 o'clock was how many months ago, maybe?
That was after the last hearing. We don't let anyone in after one.
What about, like, once you leave the place, you can't come back in? I mean, what's wrong with that?
Right, they normally don't.
After one place, you must have a cigarette. Well, that's
the only time they'll come back in. When they're having a cigarette, that's it.
You leave the place, you can't come back in.
That's all night?
No, that's...
They go for cigarette.
You just tell them if you leave the establishment, you can't come in.
Yeah, it's like a concert. Once you go outside a concert, you can't get back in. Fenway Park, you do the same thing.
Because I'm gonna make a proposal that let's see how the next 30 days go.
I mean, I'll just tell them, you know, if you leave, you can't come back.
The notice is on you guys, and that's some of the things I would look at is you leave the place, go smoke, go to another bar. But that's up to you. So if these people come back in and they start trouble, then, you know, the 30 days, we're probably going to do some serious discipline if you come back 30 days from now and there's some issues. So I have no problem with monitoring this for 30 days since they have implemented some new procedures.
There's a bunch of stuff.
It may take some time to take effect. I know there's a lot of stuff, and the last three of them were more or less just phone calls and saying this, which is good. So I don't know. That's where I stand.
And I agree with you, Commissioner. But the thing is, again, our responsibility is to keep our city safe. Mm-hmm. And I'm becoming concerned that our police officers have to go there, and from what I heard, some of them refuse to do detail there. So I think we have got to do something to get the message.
That's the only way.
Well, we could do that.
All the stuff's happening between 12 and 1, 2. So that's the only way to stop is to pull back the hours.
Right, and I do understand that. But then I also just, another way we could go. It seems like they're getting a late night crowd. I think you definitely are letting people in who have been drinking elsewhere. That's my opinion. And because you would really have to be over-serving to have this many calls.
Yeah, it's either one or the other. It's either you're over-serving or people are coming in intoxicated.
Yeah, but so, all the phone calls is made from him too, because we see
I understand. I'm not.
They're already drinking. So I'm saying maybe we should make you close your doors at 12 and have no one can enter at 12 o'clock.
You can keep the people who are in the establishment.
Yeah, that's what we were doing at 1.
You what?
That's what we were doing. Yeah, we were doing
you
that
do it at
1 now.
But for some reason, again, because this establishment is having that many problems, something has got to be done. I personally, I'm open to a motion. One of my thoughts was 12 o'clock, no one entering after 12 o'clock. You could still stay open till you 2 o'clock regular time. And maybe that's going to weave these people out that are running there for last call.
I mean, it's going to kill your restaurant business eventually. It is.
It's not worth it.
But we're not doing, I know. It's not worth the safety of people, that's for sure.
Well, the safety and your business.
I don't
want
to. Right, a combination. Well, the safety first, you know.
So, I mean, we'd like to see you take some action here. I think that rolling back the hours would definitely be an option for me. I'm inclined to maybe give you 30 days to see if you can straighten it out. But any incidents, I'm going to tell you up front. I'm going to suggest 1 o'clock. I mean, I don't want to do that, you're leaving me no choice.
No, I know. We hear you. We know. We're together. We're on your side. We love Revere. We do. We truly do. I donate to everybody.
I said to you.
I'm not like a greedy person. You know, I make my money and I take care of people. You know, I always try to help everybody. And, you know, we're not in this to put people in danger. You know.
And that's why it's not worth.
No, absolutely.
Certain
safety
people
first.
In there.
Safety
it's
first.
Just not worth it. You love your business. It is a great business. It's a beautiful place.
100%.
It is a beautiful
but
place.
You're risking a great business. Yep. You really are. And I think I have to say, you know, you've got to know who the troublemakers are. You have to know who shouldn't be there.
I've barred personally, myself, not including like any security or whatever, at least 20 people in the past 2 months. Just told them you can't ever come back here again.
Well,
you know what I mean?
Obviously.
So I don't need those people. I don't need that business, you know?
How old of a crowd do you think you're getting in there?
We have all ages. All ages.
Well, I'm talking after your dinner. Let's
even
say
even after dinner.
Two.
Like, we have, like, 70-year-old guys coming in there dancing.
But I'd say, honestly.
Single guys that, like, they're not with their wives anymore, whatever.
You know, like, I'll go in after. I go in after hockey once in a while with some buddies or with my son for dinner. And right around that 10 o'clock period. And I would say the crowd's probably like my son's age, 28, 29 years old,
it's
right around there, 27, mid-20s mostly, you know. But I mean, even he notices a difference. And you know, somebody like, you know, somebody that age bracket really isn't gonna notice it, right? But you know, I guess I'm willing to give the a 30-day trial like Commissioner LaCroix wants to do.
Right.
But I, But I'm serious. If we continue to have the incidents that we're having, and what I'd like to see is you continue to close the doors and you know work if once they're in and
yep.
And then
try to control the sidewalk. You
know? Add the extra security.
Yep.
Okay. Call the police department if a detail doesn't show up.
Yep.
Any of those violations, we'll have you back in here before that, and we'll roll the hours back. I'll make a motion to roll the hours back to 1 a.m. And you know, like I said, I don't want to do that. I mean, it's a great restaurant, and it's totally surprises me because there's so many, you know, there's so many, you know, mediocre restaurants that don't even have the issues that you guys have. So. So that's so I'm going to put that in the form of a motion what time are you closing the doors now and not letting people out? One?
Currently one, yes.
Can you try 12:30?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So 12:30, an extra security officer.
Because you know what happens, like neighboring towns, they'll leave at 12:30 just to catch the 1 o'clock because they know we're closing our doors earlier, so now they got to come earlier. That's it.
So and then notify the police department if the detail officer is available.
By 10:30, just call, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we'll table this for 30 days, and that's in the form of a motion.
Is there a rolling plan for the hour till 1 for the 30 days?
Is that legal?
No.
You want to do that? I don't know if covers are legal. I'll sell bracelets or something.
I didn't think it was legal.
I think you can charge
to charge a cover? I don't know. You know, we're celebrating our 4-year anniversary at the end of October, so you know it's a big milestone. Maybe we're proud. You know.
I'm cooking.
That's good. All right, so that's the motion. Doors close at 12:30.
Yep.
Add an extra security officer. Call the police department if there
no detail
if there's no detail on Friday and Saturday.
All right.
And no
that goes on
and,
record
and no
that we call. That goes on record that we call that night because even if you called, it might not be enough.
No, that's I want to be fair here. If it's something that you're calling because you're concerned and there's no incident, fine. But if let's say, for example, you call and somebody, you know, you're not letting somebody in and they're intoxicated, I'm not going to hold you accountable for that.
Right.
But if it was a patron that is you know, over-served and you're having trouble with him, that's up for grabs in my mind.
Okay. Thank you. We apologize.
So then the last point of my motion is that once they've got to stay in the establishment, once they leave, they're not allowed back in. At 12:30.
Okay, so after 12:30, no re-entry for anybody. Sure. That's no problem. That's
all easy. Right.
Yep.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second the motion.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We got a late renewal here.
Oh yeah, we do. Notice of late communication. Notice of cancellation of hearing from Mass Alcoholic Beverage Control Commission regarding the Dining Room Inc. DBA Sebastian's. Hearing notice from the ABCC to determine if RK and E Corp do business as BK's Bar and Grill has violated laws and regulations prohibiting gambling. Hearing date is Tuesday, November 8th at 11 a.m. Late communication hearing notice from the ABCC to determine if Revere Lodge 1171 of the BPOE of USA has violated any regulations prohibiting gambling. Hearing is set for Tuesday, January 10th, 2017 at 11 a.m. Late communication hearing notice from the ABCC to determine if Sons of Revere LLC, DBA, the Sons of Revere, has violated any laws and regulations prohibiting gambling. Hearing is dated for Tuesday, January 10th, 2017. Final late communication approval from the ABCC of a change of beneficial interest and transfer of stock for Uno's Restaurant LLC doing business as Uno's Chicago Bar and Grill. There's a motion on the table to approve a Class 2 motor vehicle dealer's license for Joseph A. DeFeo, DBA City Auto Sales and Service.
That was a late
renewal.
516 Broadway. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Next meeting is scheduled for Wednesday, October 19th. Is there a motion to close the meeting?
Motion to close the meeting.
Yes. Is there a second to that? I'll second that. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.